Suck us. Suck us.
Good evening, brothers and sisters of the leaf. Coming to you live from the corpse-ridden bowels of Camp Crystal Lake, it's the Tuesday Night Cigar Club Podcast. This place has a death curse, I tells you. Tonight, the boys talk all things premarital hanky-panky and gratuitous machete violence as they discuss the 1989 cinematic dud that is Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan. Being the scientific pairing experts that they are, our crew chemically balance out the toxic shitfest of a movie by smoking the complex Cohiba Nicaragua cigar, courtesy of Famous Smoke Shop, and slashing their way through dozens of delicious pints of the OPA, Oatmeal Pale Ale, from Ranger Creek Brewing. It sounds like the guys are going to have more fun tonight than Jason Voorhees at a horny teenage pajama party. And that's a lot of fun. So sit back, light them up, and enjoy the show.
Yeah, I want to thank you, brothers, for contributing the website. Mincy, your movie review did gangbusters on there. And Tut Cigar Review did good. And Cody, keeping up the homestead here, the physical corner of No Hope while we've been out of pocket with the new baby. I appreciate it.
Speaking of which, how are things with the newest entrant to the Cade family?
Oh,
that
man.
Was a little one.
Dude, things are fine. Everyone's very tired and cranky, Cody style. But I can't complain.
How is that a change from before the child was born?
No,
sorry.
She's a beautiful little girl. I can't wait to introduce her to you guys in another 30 years or so.
That's the safe bet.
I'm no ding-a-ling.
It is.
One thing I did notice, you know, my coffee intake has always been at, like, exceedingly dangerous levels.
Yeah.
And over the last few weeks, it's, like, catapulted into, like, very interesting.
Danger! Danger!
Exciting new levels. Yesterday morning, I was sitting down at my desk to work on the show tonight. And this is another little side effect of sleep deprivation and the new baby. Doctor, good to see you.
Likewise.
I was sitting there, and I was working on the show, and I remembered that I had brewed a cup of coffee like 20 minutes earlier, and I forgot to bring it to the desk. And all of a sudden, like loud, I go, "Great Scott, my coffee!" And I jumped up, and I ran to get my coffee, and I stopped. And I just, I very rarely laugh at myself, but I stopped and I was like, did I just say Great Scott?
Well, Doc Brown from Back to the Future? Great Scott!
That's heavy, Doc K.
See, I was thinking like Superman or like Adam West, Batman.
Oh, no, dude, that's total Doc Brown. Great Scott, Marty!
Yeah, I guess that it. But dude, I was like, I've never said Great Scott before in my life. I'm pretty sure I'll never say it again. I don't know where that came from.
Unfortunately, once you start it one time, you shocked yourself. All of a sudden, you're going to be out and about and be like, "Great Scott! No, stop it!"
Well, it was like, I guess with lack of sleep and just stress, like I just say weird shit because I remembered years ago when I moved to Florida, we drove from Texas to Florida and showed up at the apartment complex and like drove straight, a long drive. And I got to the apartment complex, and there was like a problem with the leasing paperwork, and I just lost it. I was so tired and stressed, I lost it, and I yelled at the apartment people. I was like, "This is a travesty!" I was like, "I have never seen anything like this in all my live long days." And I walked.
Sir, you're 25.
And I walked out. I walked out of the.
You don't even have many live long days.
Well, it was like a tirade circa the 1800s. Like nobody talks like that anymore.
What the Sam Hill is this?
And I got back out to the car, and my wife was like, "How'd it go? Did you get everything figured out?" I was like, "I turned into like an old gold prospector in there." Like, I said all my live long days. Like, ooh, am I Yosemite Sam? So I guess that's just the thing with me. Like when I get really tired and out of sorts,
Cade's in there quoting scripture. Proverbs 13:3, he that keepeth his mouth keepeth his life. Where's my bill?
So yeah, so that's kind of what that's how things are. In between diaper changes and crying fits, Not the baby's mind.
No, yeah.
Everything's swell. Thanks for asking.
Buddy, if you need anybody to change a diaper here,
call Mincy.
Tut'll be glad to step up to the plate.
I know. It's just going to take us so long to take these microphones off the table and put me up there. And well, you know what? We got all night.
Yeah. And you know me. I never travel great distances without talcum powder.
Weird, wacky stuff.
It would be unhealthy.
Thank you, everybody. Welcome to the Tuesday Night episode, Tuesday Night Cigar Club episode 31.
31.
That is not a travesty.
That is not a travesty.
And I will admit, in all my livelong days, I never thought we'd get this far.
What the same wheel?
One might say, Great Scott, 31 episodes.
Great Scott, 31 episodes?
My God, we've done this 30. I'm out.
Holy shit.
You owe me a Coke.
It's been a while. And thank you all for bearing with us. I did reproduce, and that we had to take a little siesta from the airwaves. But we've been trying to keep up with some web content, some reviews, and stuff in the meantime. And it's going to be a weird month because we got Cats Fest coming up right around the corner. So this will probably be our last show. Or we'll do this show, come out for Friday 13th. If you're listening to this, it's Friday 13th.
We want
to get this out there for Friday 13th. And we shall meet again at Cats Fest and do our Cats Fest interviews and a big show. And then we'll get back to normal over the summer.
Yeah.
But thanks.
Looking forward to it because we got some really good shows coming up. I am excited about some of
these. It's going to be a good summer. Things are heating up.
Bonsai!
Man, I'm going to just touch on this briefly. Today, the hammer came down from the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, basically trying to put the boot heel on the neck of the premium cigar industry. Not enough is really been digested at this point. This is literally hours ago. Even following guys like Steve Saka and the manufacturers that we go to for their take on these things, they haven't even really had a chance. It's 499 pages.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's anything legal, you have to.
It's 500 pages of regulations that were handed down today.
Basically, they can print whatever they want because they know no one's going to read it.
No, that's pretty much it.
Page 272 says men must all wear duck-billed caps in public from now on. What does this have to do with the Food and Drug Administration?
Well, that's not the worst idea I've ever heard. But no, it's way too soon, but it's some really crippling things in there, especially to some of the newer guys, like our good friends at RomaCraft and Steve. We'll address this, I'm sure, at Cats Fest. With some of our interviews.
I'll be very curious to see what the temperature of Cats
Fest is. Me too, because if the FDA thing works, you can say goodbye to cigar festivals, basically. You can say goodbye to a lot of the things we've enjoyed and peacefully, without hurting anybody, including ourselves, might be taken away from us by those people.
Now we'll have to start going back to those things.
Who know better?
Unpeacefully hurting others and ourselves.
Right? But anyway, it's kind of a somber note, but...
Well, that's the one thing I said that you can trust. You can always trust government to take more power for itself, regardless of who's in the office. It's been fun reading all the "Thanks Obama" posts. I was like, no. Thanks government. Thanks politics. This was Democrats and Republicans. This is bipartisan. They want power. They're going to take power.
You're absolutely right. So that was kind of a shitty. I was so excited to get back there in the corner, no hope, and do tonight's episode, and that kind of took the wind out of my sails. But you know what? It's early. There is still a fight in Congress, and hopefully very quickly into the Senate to combat some of this arbitrary bullshit that they...
Y'all keep saying that, and I'm all doom and... I'm on board the doom and gloom train.
I remember when Drew Estate sold to Swisher, how long ago was that now?
I don't know.
2 years?
Year and a half. Yeah, about a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
We were in Dallas at the time, so about a year and a half ago, and I went and stocked up on Ligas, and I'm like, Swisher bought Drew Estate, I better stock up on Ligas and Undercrowns, and nothing changed, they're still the same.
No, they never changed the formula until about 2 years after.
Joke's on me. But you know what, I think it is far too...
You might say it's far too early to tell, Mr. K?
Yes, I would.
God, the anticipation, though, to cigar smokers everywhere. It's just unimaginable.
It is unimaginable.
My God, the anticipation they must all be feeling right now.
It is my job to not let it damper tonight's mood, this black cloud of, impending prohibition
impending
of cigars.
Doom. I'm with you, Tut. The sooner you and I can go get to that abandoned sawmill up in Nova Scotia, the better.
Fuck yeah, man.
So that's all I'm going to say about that. More on that in the next few shows.
Still trying to convince my wife. I was like, we need to move in with Mincy and the abandoned sawmill.
Run that by Mincy?
You
have a girl living there with you?
Yeah, whoa there, Tut. That
cuts into a lot of the kind of freaky gay stuff you had in mind. Am I right, Mincy?
It's far too early to tell. There won't be any freaky gay
as he's,
stuff
as
going
he's
on.
Pushing away his gimp suit behind the chair.
Tut, could, as long as we're starting things on such a somber, unpleasant note, could you grab the Boot of Remembrance?
Oh, no.
For us, we forgot to grab it here earlier. We unfortunately our first time back in the corner here in a while, and we've had some loss in our creative world. We always pour a little bit of our beer out for those that had an impact on us. Were you just showcasing your? What are you doing?
Kind of hogging the spotlight there a little bit.
Were you showing your ass off to the camera?
Get some screen time.
Oh, man. Oh, it's because he took his headphones off. It's the first time anybody's ever seen his ears on the show. He does have ears. They're elf ears, but they're...
My dozens and dozens of fans have written, and they want more Tuttle.
Tonight, we're going to pour out a little bit to two folks. The first... in no particular order.
Yeah.
Let's do Prince first.
Okay.
We lost Prince since the last time.
We lost Prince. As a musician,
that's why I'm going to you. You're the music guy.
It's always funny because, and I was having this conversation. You know, there's no way that you can call Prince underappreciated or just under anything. I mean, he was pretty much industry wide was. Accepted as a genius.
I never heard anybody question his musical talent. If anything, I think he was maybe an underrated guitar player.
Yeah.
Apparently, he was an amazing drummer. I heard that he could do a bass solo that would just...
I was about to say, in terms of composition, in terms of producing, in terms of being in a studio, I think he's one of the greatest minds that we've had of our generation. He was brilliant. His musical composition is just... impeccable. You can't really touch it. When he would take the bass out of an entire song, and his record producer labels are going, you know, you're stupid. Put the bass in there, and he's like, no, this is what's going to hit, and it does, and it goes number one. I mean, nobody has the balls to do that.
Yeah.
And yet, when you look at him, and it was so funny because I heard the line he redefined masculinity. Well, I guess he. Because at the time it was very controversial. He was wearing like high-heeled boots, you know.
Yeah, but he always had
the
ladies.
All the makeup.
He always had the ladies.
Oh, he had the beautiful deep voice.
And Chi Lee, for God's sake.
Pancakes, anyone?
And who's the one that is...
Vanity?
Vanity, she just died last year or this year?
He was one of those fun... growing up in East Texas with all my redneck cowboy friends... They always got to kind of chuckle that I listened to Prince and that I revered Prince.
And by chuckle, he means they beat him senseless.
They beat the shit out of him.
And they called him Fruit Boots. And I called him Fruit Boots. Because literally, I mean, when you look at the guy, he was wearing like 6-inch stiletto
that's
boots.
That's such an East Texas thing.
We listened to Fruit Boots.
But he was such, I mean, he
It didn't
was,
help that Tuttle had a backpack shaped like the sign of Prince, the symbol.
Which was so funny because, you know, that, I mean, that was one of those things to where when he did the sign, I was like, what the hell is this? He's out in left field. Yeah. This is before the internet really was out there, so he didn't know what was going on except for what was being reported. Mm-hmm. And then when you find out after the fact, he was battling his record company, and I'm like...
Clever ploy to get...
Hell yeah, man. Fight on, dude. Fight on. I was
kind of indifferent. You know, his 80s big output, I guess, Purple Rain, Doves Cry, maybe. I really like Kiss.
That's
the
one
Sign
of my
of
favorite
the Times.
Yeah.
That Sign of the Times stuff.
Seven. I like all that.
I know Mincy was a big Diamonds and Pearls guy.
Let me give you diamonds and pearls.
I was a Diamonds and Pearl necklace guy. But I mean, his talent was unquestionable, and it's been weird that the people I've seen, you know, on Facebook that you would never even suspect, they like,
yeah,
oh, they're just crushed by it. It's funny how, that's why we do the boot. It's funny how celebrity deaths affect certain people. Rowdy Roddy Piper got us a certain way.
I know my wife. She was generally upset. I mean, she was just, I'm in a
funk. You guys, big Prince fans?
I like his music.
Fairweather Prince fans?
I'm Fairweather. I mean, you know, his 80s stuff.
I appreciate a good eccentric. I like eccentric guys that I don't think it's an act. I think they're just really eccentric in cool ways. Like, they just do really bizarre, weird shit.
Well, when you have... If you are eccentric, if you're trying to pull off the genius eccentric, that's cool, but you better have the genius product to back it up.
Well, see, that's where I go wrong.
Exactly.
I try to pull that's that totally shit, where you go and here on. We are in this...
But it was funny because we have this tradition in the Tuttle household called 80s Pancake Saturday, where I bake pancakes and we watch an 80s movie. So we watch Purple Rain, and the entire time I'm thinking Dave Chappelle, would you like some pancakes?
See, I never saw him.
Thanks for the invite to that, by the way.
It's open invitation, man.
Yeah. You live like 4 hours away from him. The pancakes would be just fathomably soggy by then.
Whose side are you on?
Doc Mincy. Do you want some pancakes?
I'm on your side. I'm sorry.
Would anyone like some grapes? Game. But no, game, bitches.
It's one of those things to where you were like, Tuttle talk about Prince, and it's kind of hard because he was all over the news and all over the TV. I mean, you pretty much have heard everything about him now.
Well, the fact that I think you did a very good job. So we're going to pour a little bit out to Prince. I'm not going to ask for two pours because I know that'll lead to a revolt with you guys. We'll do one pour at the end.
I'll actually pour to both.
One last comment on it.
It's one of his guys. We'll pour to both.
I think Prince, even though no one can argue the impact that he had and how big of a star he was, I think for people our age that grew up as part of the MTV generation,
right?
Because for me, that's when his best stuff was in the 80s.
Yeah.
And, you know, MTV, when it played videos when we were kids, was such a big part of our lives and kind of what we listened to growing up. So there's definitely a huge impact there as well.
Okay. Well, speaking of something that was really big in our youth, you know, we're going back not quite as far as the 80s, but late 90s.
Yeah.
We're all pretty big wrestling fans. And
are we going to have to apologize like we did on the last
show?
No,
no apologies, and we're not going to drag this out. But one of the biggest forces of nature in that I think we'd all say the best era, the Attitude Era of wrestling, the late era, 90s, 2000, one of the most unique forces of nature that just every time she walked out, you couldn't help but just watch her, was China.
Yeah.
Part of D-Generation X, Triple H's henchwoman, just completely revolutionized the role of females.
Right.
I mean, there's Miss Elizabeth, who was always your typical
damsel in distress,
and then all of a sudden there's China, body slamming fucking dudes and just kicking ass.
Yeah.
So I asked Cody to just briefly give us a little something to remember. What was her real name? Joni?
Joni Lohrer.
Joni,
yeah. Lohrer. She, you know, and I didn't even realize this because when I started looking it up, I was like, she really was not that long in with the WWE.
She had a short but very
four years from 97 to 2001. I could have sworn it was like a decade.
I thought it was a decade too. Yeah.
And that really floored me when I started looking back at like, wait, no. She was in there for the beginning of night. No.
But boy, she hit it hard and she just.
And that was really, you know, when she got involved, it really did change a lot for them, especially because, you know, they were trying to, you know, especially the media started to change. Internet was, you know, slowly starting to kind of coalesce into a shape we recognize today, and that was really affecting them and cable and all that other stuff. But they, I mean, when she came in, it was kind of like a game changer for them because she was, it wasn't just that there was a female on the side of the ring, now there was an actual female in
and
the ring.
She was kind of cute.
She was.
I mean, she had huge deltoids. Sure.
She was almost more like a fitness model.
She was like a fitness model, but I mean, she wasn't. You know, there's a lot of those.
But she was not a female bodybuilder.
She was not a female bodybuilder.
just a female roid taker.
Yes.
Well, they all did, but that's neither. You know.
I'm sorry, that is not natural. That's not natural, China.
She won the Intercontinental. I know. Remember, she was the only female to ever win the Intercontinental Championship. I mean, just the stuff she would do. Oh, the fact that she could hang with Triple H and literally be his enforcer. I mean, come on.
And she, I mean, you know, she said, you know, one of the, like for the wrestling, the Royal Rumble, she was the first woman ever to be in a Royal Rumble.
A lot of firsts. And, you know, once she got out of the business, she certainly took a lot of interesting roads from there. She was in Playboy early on after
most
WWE.
Most sold edition
ever of Playboy.
I did not know that. I have 32 copies.
She did some adult films. She did a lot of stuff. But
she ended up doing to the wrestling circuit in Japan for about 4 years.
But ultimately, she had a substance abuse problem, and it sounds like from what everybody's saying that did her in. At the end, but
and she was, I mean, still very young, 46.
But if we fill the boot to people that are cultural. Leave their stamps on our brains. She certainly did, as wrestling fans.
Triple H, let her in, man.
Yeah, let her in.
You
got
to let her in, dude.
Yeah, let her in.
You have to, man. Yeah. I don't want to hear this. What am I going to tell my daughter? Same thing you tell your daughter about X-Pac when you let him back into the fold.
He did porn, too.
Yeah.
I own 20 copies of that.
Let her in, man. I love you, Triple H.
All right, well, starts with two pours per Tuts. Give a little bit to Prince. A little bit to China.
I'll give it. There we go.
Hey.
A lot of wasting going on here. The doctor won't be wasting.
Look at the doctor taking matters in his own hands.
If you're going to pour to the boot of remembrance.
If you're going to use the boot of remembrance.
Come on. One. For two.
Mincy's now pouring the boot of remembrance into his pint glass. Good.
If you're going to use some sort of shoe of remembrance, the least you can do is make sure that it's centrally located.
Oh, you're going to understand that voice we're using a lot better here in about 30 minutes. So, Buddha Remembrance, Prince in China, possibly the Buddha Remembrance to the premium cigar industry soon. I hope not. Real quick, I do want to say a word about Cats Fest 4. We're all pumped.
We are.
Cats Fest 4 is right around the corner. This will be our last show before Cats 4. Memorial Day weekend, beginning May 26th and running through the 29th. This is the biggest cigar festival.
San Antonio, Texas.
There's a lot of cigar festivals out there right now. Well, we're still allowed to do them, Mom and Dad.
Thanks, Nanny State.
Thanks, government. But while us grown adults are still allowed to do some things, get your ass to Cats Fest. We are going to be there doing live interviews all day on Saturday. But it technically begins Thursday, the 26th. There's a Drew Estate event at Redland Cigars in San Antonio. Pedro Rodriguez is going to be there from Drew Estate. He's a real popular guy. Friday night, there's going to be the VIP dinner. And big time, you want to be there at the host hotel, the La Quinta, at Stone Oaks.
Friday night, I will have my table set up where you just hear me rant about the Nanny State.
Oh, he's going to go nuts. You guys keep a leash on him.
It'll be epic.
Stone Oaks, La Quinta Inn. That's where everyone meets the night before, and you just basically, we take over the parking lot. The whole hotel is nothing but cigar smokers. You set up your chair, you get your booze, and you just meet folks, and you smoke. And it was last year, that's where we met Steve Socker for the first time. That's where we met just a ton of folks.
Robert Holt. Asylum guys, the Core Zero guys.
Yeah, it was just a great time to just kick back, drink, smoke, and just relax and meet everybody before the big day, the Saturday at Tejas Rodeo Grounds is where the main event is. If you just are only interested in the festival itself, you can get a day pass for that. You show up, you get your goodie bag, and you go around to all the different vendor booths. You get
It's sad because this is the one industry where you can't. What other industry can you go to a festival and talk to the head of these companies.
Yeah. And they'll show you.
I mean, and they talk to you. It's not like, oh, you're guest number 134. Hi, I am the head of this company. Thank you for liking my product. Next. You're guest 135. Hi, I'm the head of this company. Thank you. No, these guys are accessible. They answer your questions. They BS with you. It's great.
It's one of the reasons I was easily pulled away from the film world to the cigar world. Because it's apples and oranges.
Yeah.
You can go to the very top guys in the cigar industry, icons, and they will sit there for 3 hours, and you feel like they're interested in talking to you, and they want to know what brought you to them, not, you know, what... There's no my shit doesn't stink attitude from these guys, and it's just awesome. If you have any interest in cigars, if you have any interest in picking the brains of the people that make the cigars you like, get your ass to Cat's Fest. That Saturday, like I said, that you just go around, you meet all these different vendors, all these different manufacturers. You'll get free samples. You'll leave there with a huge bag of cigars, some other good, you know, cool fun stuff. There's great food at the Tejas Rodeo, cold beer, live music all day long.
You'll meet great people. I met my reverend at the Cigar Fest.
Met the guy who, a New York reverend, our buddy Rev Java, at Cat's Fest, and about, what, a year later, he flew down and married him, and he's one of our closest dudes.
That was so cool. It was very, very cool.
And then throughout the day, they have raffles. They got beard mustache competitions. This year, they've got a blending seminar with Kendall Culberson of Outlaw Cigar. Yeah. He's going to do a blending cigar, like we went to TJ's with Black Label. He's going to be doing that. Black Label's also doing a cat cigar for everyone who comes.
Yeah, I saw that.
Everyone's going to get an exclusive cat cigar.
I'm looking forward to that.
All going
to
get one of those. That night, there's Operation Cigars for Warriors Rodeo at there. There's going to be a rodeo.
Is that Saturday night?
I believe that's Saturday night. Yep. And then I'm going to be escorting you guys that night to the Cats Country Western Goodnight Dance. Bring your dancing shoes, boys.
I always do.
I've got us entered in several competitions.
The doctor will be having to, I'm afraid, leave early.
Medical emergency?
Yes.
We'll
Much like the FDA is crippling cigar companies, the AMA is attempting to cripple the doctor.
I've heard rumors.
Sorry, carry on.
Well, here's the great thing. Whenever you've had
put together with the AMO.
Whenever you've had your fill, because it is, like, there's literally stuff going on all day. Whenever you've had your fill, San Antonio's a great spot, full of great restaurants. Get your ass back to that hotel, because at the La Quinta...
I will still be there ranting.
Once you get back to the La Quinta, you take your lawn chair out in the parking lot. The whole parking lot is roped off.
Yeah.
Plant your seat, light up, and you're going to meet a whole nother round of new folks that night.
Yeah.
So look for us. We're going to be wearing Tuesday Night Cigar Club t-shirts. We're going to be drunk. We're going to be...
Ranting.
Just
listen for
you
the...
You may even see the doctor, and don't hesitate to come up and say hello.
And we're going to have some merch for sale. Come see us at our... At our table.
That is cool.
In between interviews, we're just going to be kind of hanging out. We're going to have some Tuesday night Cigar Club shirt. Some swag. Come buy a shirt.
I'm just going to sit at Tut's rant table and keep feeding him margaritas. So
I like the sound of that.
You know, it's funny you mentioned
starting
that.
Starting to calm down a little bit. Tut, have another drink.
It's funny you mentioned that, Doctor. Sunday, May 29th, the last day of the festival, there's a chili cook-off at 8 a.m.
We'll be making that.
Oh wait, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m.
Oh, okay. Jesus Christ. They obviously don't know the hours the doctor keeps.
But then at 3:30 p.m. there is a margarita competition. So
and Tuttle is still ranting.
And
he will not get off his soapbox.
There's also a music fest, just too many bands here to name. So really, if you have a little money put aside for a summer trip, and you're interested in, you know, exploring cigars, it's a great way to start.
It is.
Come down,
awesome,
you'll get a bag full of, you know, 40, 50 cigars from all different people. You'll just fall in love with the culture, you know, right before it's ripped away from us.
Yeah, you'll understand why the culture was so threatening to freaking America.
Yeah, you understand how much trouble we're causing.
I'm totally going to push your button, so you keep doing that. I'm on touch.
Get the moral of the story, get your ass to Cat's Fest. Come see us at our booth in between interviews. Like I said, we're just gonna be hanging out, smoking. We'd love to talk to you. Go to catsfestival.com for more information and
tickets.
I actually
still need to get my tickets.
There's, yeah, I think we all still need to get our tickets. But there's a VIP ticket, which gets you in the VIP dinner Friday and Saturday. There's a day pass for Saturday. There's, I think for $5 more you can go to the blending seminar and see how cigars actually roll.
That alone. That's a bargain. For $5? Come
$5
on.
$5 is a bargain. So,
we've spent anywhere between $30 and $60 for those types of things. $5, do it.
Don't be an asshole. Do it. Go to the website, buy a ticket.
Do it. Also, check out the steaks at that Taos place, man. They're pretty good.
Yeah, it was a really good steak at that VIP dinner in less than. Also, I should just mention, you get some really cool swag. I'm drinking tonight out of my Cats Festival pint glass I got last year. And it's got the Deadwood Tobacco logo on the back. And you get all sorts of cool shit.
Yeah. Meet Vaughn from Deadwood.
Meet Vaughn Boy. She won't talk to us, but she'll talk to you.
She won't talk to us, but that is so true.
She actually had t-shirts made that said that. I won't talk to Tuesday Night Cigar Club, but I'd be more than happy to talk to you. No, she's awesome. So go to catsfestival.com and get some tickets, and we'll see you there. Let's party. Let's party our fucking asses off. Right, boys?
Like it's 1999?
Like it's 1999, if that helps. Are you going to be able to stay awake for Cats Fest?
Once I get going, I'll be in my element.
All right.
I'm the guy that stays up till 4 a.m. anyways.
That's true.
That's true.
Catsfestival.com. Buy your tickets and we'll see you there. While we're talking about cigars.
Okay.
How about I introduce tonight's cigar?
It's about time. I've been sitting here
for this one bitch up already.
Any objections? I've forgotten we even do that.
We do tend.
I mean, thank God we at least get to open the beer when we start the show. We can't light up until
We do every once in a while discuss a cigar. And tonight, we've got a doozy. Feel that. That's a big bad guy in your hand there. We're smoking.
Just do not have words to describe.
Do, but they're all pornographic, and I shall
bigger than a ballpark game hot dog.
That is right.
It's a tremendous wiener.
It's a tremendous wiener.
Tonight we are going to be smoking the Cohiba Nicaragua.
Did you say Nicaragua?
I did. N6x60. It's also right there on the band of the cigar.
I'm too drunk to read that. Truth be known,
we haven't even got to the movie.
I was about to say, I've been into the scotch. I've been into the beer. I had a couple of pre-show beers.
I really miss you guys.
It's
been too long. It's good to be back.
Rock and roll ain't noise pollution.
Got the band back together.
Wait, is this the band with Axl or the band with Angus?
No, let's not get that. Okay. It's too early for that.
It's too soon.
The Cohiba Nicaragua 6x60. It's a double Toro. It's listed as full strength. I'm not going to go in as we do now. I won't give price till afterwards. We'll discuss that.
It's Cohiba, so it's $23.
We'll let Tug guess. Wrapper origin is Honduran, which I thought was kind of odd that it's the Cohiba.
The Nicaraguan. It's Honduran.
But if you look, where this was grown is literally a fence line on the border of Nicaragua. So, all right.
It's grown in disputed territory between the two. They're fighting a war about it as we speak.
But the binder and filler is pure Nicaraguan. The wrapper leaf is...
Smells great.
It does, doesn't it?
It really does smell great.
The wrapper leaf...
I'm not waiting. I haven't even lit it. I'm just smelling what you guys have done.
The wrapper leaf is a Colorado Oscuro wrapper.
Why do they call it a Colorado?
That's the shade. That's just the description of the color.
Oh, okay, so it's not...
It's like a Maduro. It's a Honduran... Colorado Oscuro.
Well, I thought the Connecticut leaves were actually grown in Connecticut for a time.
It's grown in Honduran, but then there's some leaves that come from the Rocky Mountains.
Why are they called a Connecticut leaf?
Connecticut was a big tobacco state.
Our legitimacy as a cigar podcast
is just
going up in flames. Like the
My God,
the
legitimacy
movie.
Is just sunk. It's just sinking like a puss in boots.
Well, you said you used to think that. You know better now.
That is right. Once I started listening to the Tuesday Night Cigar Club, Night Cigar Club educated me on the leaves.
Go. Well, let me tell you a little bit about the cigar. Let me get you this from the Famous Smoke Shop. This is their description of it. TheFamousSmokeShop.com. They sent us these cigars for review, so thank you, Famous Smoke Shop. Cohiba goes full tilt, full body, and leaves the Dominican Republic behind to do it. For those of you who don't know, the non-Cuban Cohibas are primarily Dominican cigars. So
correct.
This is a big step away from their comfort zone. The goal, to blend a Nicaraguan that smokes Cohiba Rich, and boy, have they hit the mark. Clad in oily Honduran sun-grown Oscuro.
It is oily.
This proprietary Cohiba blend is lush to the core, making for a spicy, feisty boldness.
Let's smoke.
But still surprises with a touch of sweetness. And in classic Cohiba style, the Nicaragua smokes cool and creamy to the finish.
Okay.
We'll That's see. What Famous tells us. Boy, I want to light up because the aroma coming off you guys is really nice.
It is nice. I'll have to.
And it's a very nice looking cigar. There's some, you know, some nice sized veins, but just oily is. I mean, just a really.
It really is.
Kind of.
It's really nice.
Really kind of silky, oily texture.
Now, I have to warn Famous in full disclosure, I'm not a fan of the 60 gauge.
Well, that is a point of thing. A lot of guys are not fans of the larger ring, 60 ring
plus gauges. It just makes so many of us feel inadequate for some reason we can't quite put our fingers on.
You're compensating for something. So
I don't know why.
I'll admit, I don't mind when my favorite large ring gauge is the Uzis.
Yeah.
The original, my Uzi weighs a ton from Drew Estate. They only came in 60 ring gauge. And I don't mind it. If it's
You're the one who actually got me to try 60 gauge because I know that you really liked, I think it was the Uzis, also the Hoya.
The 1970, Grand Console.
Grand Console.
Is one of my favorites, too. So if it's blended, it's all about the blend.
I kind of think so.
If you don't fuck up the blend by going bigger and just screw up the filler ratio to
appease the ring
gauge. If you blend
gauge,
it to the size, there's no reason why you shouldn't like it.
I don't like 60 gauges. I don't. They make me feel sad, inferior. But I do like the Grand Console, and it might be because it's blended for that size.
Well, let's not judge this by its size. That's the second time I've said that this week.
Only the second.
In the words of my wife,
it's still very good.
But let's light it up and see what. But again, just smelling you guys, the aroma is.
The aroma is beautiful.
I'm going to come back to it in a minute once we've all lit up.
I haven't even lit right now. I'm just rambling.
Let me come
beautiful.
Back to it once we've all had a chance here.
I'm afraid of what all the criticism I'm about to lot on this thing, so I'm praying right now.
I will say the reason I picked it, Cohiba leaves its comfy home of the Dominican Republic to explore new territory. Kind of like the central figure in tonight's film.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, an element of foreshadowing.
Whoa, very smart.
He's not the head honcho around here for no good reason.
I thought I'd gotten a little lazy with our pairings over the last few episodes. But well, they both start with the letter M.
Wait, that's lazy?
So I am.
It's a tremendous amount of effort.
That's.
So that does play in out of its element and something new. And just like our beloved Cats Fest, tonight's beer comes from San Antonio.
San Antonio.
You see, fellas, everything's coming together.
And the man has taken care of a newborn infant. Look at this guy. Does he ever sleep?
It's performance amazing. Enhancing drugs.
You, sir.
I'm guilty.
Amazing.
Thank I was you. Wondering what all those broken deer antlers I saw out in the yard when I was visiting you earlier.
I'm hopped up on ground up deer antler. I just don't know what to do with all the carcasses.
I was wondering why I saw Ray Lewis hanging around outside of his house.
Cody, educate us on tonight's beer.
Tonight's beer comes to us from Ranger Creek Brewing.
Never heard of it.
They are fairly new, been around since 2010. And as you just said, they are out of San Antonio. Now, versus most brewers, they are not just a brewer. They are also a distillery. They are making their own whiskeys. So.
What's going on over there?
He's hit you a little harsh there, Tut?
Just a deep breath of awesomeness what has happened.
But tonight we are drinking the... At first I thought it was the OPA.
OPA!
Oh, cool. OPA! All right.
Oh, it's an OPA like an IPA.
Yeah, it is OPA.
Speaking of, if you could round us up another round.
Boy, we've been gabbing. We're already ready for another.
Boys, another one?
Yes.
Yeah. It is the oatmeal pale ale.
Two flavors that you do not really put together.
Correct. And at first I was thinking they made an IPA, but they added oatmeal.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, that's not what they did. It is an American-style pale ale.
Yeah.
But it's not as, you know, the... And when we... especially now when we think of an IPA, we really tend to think, you know, that it's just super hoppy, and this one actually is not, from what from the description. They're only saying it comes in right around, like, you know, 33-35 IBU, so it has
I would have guessed higher.
Actually would have.
I mean, it's not crazy bitterness, yeah, but I would have guessed higher than that.
I agree.
But obviously, also going back, that, you know, they added oatmeal, which people tend to think of oatmeal, they tend to think of a stout.
Stout.
I mean, you know, oatmeal stouts are very common nowadays, but oatmeal with a pale ale, not so much. Seeing that, you know, it...
So Ranger Creek takes oats, which are usually associated with stouts, and drops them into unfamiliar territory with the pale ale, sort of like the central figure in tonight's
film. I'm going to ask you to stop talking
in tonight's film. He's unleashed a rain terror in unfamiliar territory, Amara. Everything's coming together. Has anyone ever had this beer before?
I have not. I'm a fan of the American... I'm not a big IPA guy, but I do like American pale ales. They're usually a little less hoppy.
Yeah.
We've done an American pale ale on the show, right?
We have. And, you know, and for a while there, people were trying to use the designation for the American pale ale to be the super hoppy. And I don't know if that's really as caught on as much as they've tried. And it really hasn't. I mean, because normally when I think of the American pale ale style, that means, you know, you're looking at an IBU of like 100.
I'm kind of curious about this, how y'all will like it, because
I love it.
Right now I'm a fan of it.
I love it.
And I'm not a big hop guy, so I was kind of thinking that if I like it, maybe it's too tame for you guys.
Well, I mean, at 30, you're not really getting the bitterness. You're getting some of the flavor of the hop, but you're not getting that the burn.
I think so.
I like it a lot.
It's very good. It's right around a 5.8% ABV. And overall, I mean, like they said, they denoted that the oatmeal gives it more towards the grain, the nuttiness.
I haven't tasted
flavor.
The oatmeal at all.
But I am picking up more the IPA style. I'm getting a lot of very citrus, very floral.
Yeah, that's the way I am.
In terms of...
I'm not tasting the oatmeal at all.
If we drink enough of it, will that fulfill our daily whole grain needs?
I think it probably should. Yeah.
Well, I was going to surprise you with this, guys, but the cat's out of the bag. Tonight, we're Skyping in for an interview with the Quaker Oats Man.
Dun, dun, dun!
I did see that this, I think...
Wait, was that the Captain Chaos movie music?
May have been. I don't know.
Was it the Chupacabra that used the Amarillo hops? There was a beer we did in the early stages that used Amarillo hops. And I saw where this beer also uses...
I do remember the Amarillo
hops. Grown in Amarillo. Yeah.
My nickname as a high school basketball player was Amarillo Hops.
He was terrible.
They can't get off the ground, so it wasn't really a compliment of any kind.
Just awful. Oatmeal IPA. That's different. Everything we're doing tonight is a little bit... Off center from how we
usually. I'm kind of treating the oatmeal like Cody's butter. I'm waiting for it.
When he got the oatmeal, I'm not tasting any oatmeal on this.
Yeah, I'm not either.
And I eat oatmeal every other day for breakfast, so I'm somewhat of an oatmeal connoisseur.
Apparently, I am a fan of the American American pale ale.
Yeah,
because
what other beer we did that wasn't American? Was it the Ghost Rider? The Ghost?
No.
Ghost Rider.
Don Dedieu was Canadian.
Ghost Rider was just an IPA, I believe.
Is that just an IPA?
Yeah.
We did do an American. It's just all bells and whistles at this point.
That's the problem. Go to our website. Find out for us which one that we did.
To tell us what we've said.
Usually by hour three, we have no clue. We don't.
We all saw... Tut fall out of his chair on the initial light up of the cigar. I think he got a little bit of spice. For me, there was a little, not an overpowering spice lighting up, but it transitioned very quickly to creaminess. Are you guys getting that?
To tell you the truth, no, I'm not.
I'm getting cream.
I kind of had the same experience here. I got a big strong hit there at the beginning.
Yeah, there was a nice little blast of spice there. A good blast of spice. I mean, it was very flavorful.
I'm going to say the initial before I lit it, I got a very strong just aroma of coffee. I mean, like, really, I mean, it was like cappuccino strong coffee.
Okay. Well,
but I don't know if that was maybe a combination with the beer and this, just, but I didn't get that after I lit up, just that aroma afterward. But when I lit, it almost went to the other way. I got a little bit like chocolate.
Yeah.
On the on taste profile.
Yeah.
Well, you do get, I mean, never mind.
Right now, I had some spice, and it's really transitioned to just a really nice cream. And I think I had a little bit of coffee. Yeah, I get the, I'm getting a little bit of coffee and cream.
That's just what I mean, it was very, very strong. And like I said, now it's kind of gone. I'm not getting any spice right now, but I mean, it could be too early.
For me, the spice went away pretty quick.
Yeah, it did. It really did.
Well, I'm literally like 2 centimeters into it, so we'll come back. Everybody just kind of got started on these guys. Well, you know, we mentioned tonight's movie a lot. You know, we're drinking a beer that is taking oatmeal into a different direction than it's been. We're smoking a Cohiba from Nicaragua, which isn't really the norm. And tonight's movie definitely follows that trend. Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, 1989. Man, I can't believe we haven't run. I can't believe we haven't done a Friday the 13th yet.
I know. As much paraphernalia in the studio.
The corner of No Hope here is littered with...
If we took the camera and panned, it's nothing but, you know, Jason Voorhees, Leatherface, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
There's a lot of collectible figures.
Well, for Cade and I think we both...
You guys are huge.
Halloween was our favorite, but Friday the 13th is right up there. As far as the series goes, this would have been, as Cade mentioned, an 89 release. It was the 8th Friday the 13th movie in the 10-year period of 80 to 89. They only had 2 years that they didn't release a movie.
And an interesting note of trivia, it is the last film in the series to use Friday the 13th in the title. After this, they ditched it. Everything else was...
All right, Freddy vs. Jason.
Jason Goes to Hell, Freddy vs. Jason, Jason X.
Until the remake 20
until
years
the remake.
Later.
I don't count that.
Yeah.
But, this was kind of the swan song. Yeah. Interest was kind of waning in the series at this point when this came
I'd
out.
I'd be curious to get y'all's take on the remake.
We can get into that once over. Yeah. It was written and directed by Rob Hedden. He wrote the Stone Cold Steve Austin flick, The Condemned.
The Condemned?
Yeah.
And most recently, he wrote and directed the 2001 cheesy rom-com, You May Not Kiss the Bride. And the only reason I know that is because my daughter's best friend at school, her uncle, played the lead in it.
Oh, okay. Wild.
So it was on Amazon, and it's like, oh, hey, it's...
That is not the only reason Kate knows that. Well, he has VHS, DVD, and Laserdisc copies of the film.
It was a fine little romantic comedy. But yeah, the actor and the guy's name Dave Annabelle, and he's uncle of my daughter's best friend. So it was on, and why not?
Married to the lovely Odette.
Yes, she was on House.
Yeah. Yes.
She was on the series House.
I think she was in Cloverfield, actually. The first one.
Okay. Well, they're very nice people. We had a play date together one day at the park, and they're very cool. They visit frequently down here in Texas from Los Angeles, and he's on a new show, Heartbeat, some doctor hospital drama.
Of course.
So those are the resume highlights of this guy for me. He did... he also directed a handful of MacGyvers, which is always awesome.
Yeah.
And he wrote the 1991 Knight Rider TV movie.
Okay, so if he's in MacGyver and Knight Rider, I'm just going to dial...
No, not the actor. The guy who wrote and directed the movie.
But he wrote, yeah. I'm going to dial down my poo throwing a little bit tonight, just because of that.
He has hands in some cool stuff. Yeah. A little background real quick.
Obviously not this one.
Friday Part 7, that came before this, made a respectable $20 million at the box office. The profits have been slowly diminishing with each new hour.
Right, they hit the pinnacle with about part four, which is where they called it the final chapter, and that's where they're going to have Tom Savini come back.
And then a year later, they had a new beginning.
You'd only do it if you could kill Jason.
and
the
Jason
year later,
lives.
Yeah.
And then the part seven was
the new blood.
The new blood, and then we had to do something different here. But that's half that $20 million was half the same summer Nightmare on Elm Street 4 came out, Dream Warriors. And that was half of what it made. So people were gravitating towards the new kid on the block.
Dream Warriors
Freddy.
Was an awesome movie, man.
Everyone is going kind of towards Freddy, the new guy. A fresher franchise, at least.
Yeah.
And so producers greenlit Friday 13th Part 8.
Because we should point out also, Kay, that they were still making these Fridays dirt cheap.
Very cheap.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
one was the highest budgeted one ever, I believe, at $5 million.
Wow.
But the director, he...
$5 million for this.
Well, they had to shoot three scenes in Manhattan.
Yeah,
we'll
true.
Save that
yeah.
One, maybe. but the director hadn't pitched the idea of spicing things up. He was like, well, one, can I kill Jason? Because I get in the vibe from you guys, you're kind of over him.
Sure, we do that every
yeah,
movie.
Yeah, really,
yeah,
right.
Like, what's the matter?
We're not really signing anything here that we can't undo.
No, and then also,
can I... killed him in seven previous movies.
More importantly, he was like, can I yank him out of Crystal Lake? Let's get out of this redundant thing, and can I take him somewhere else? And that's when the longtime Friday producer, Frank Mancuso Jr., said, New York City. Let's put him in New York. And so they
one, I want to take Jason. Two, I want to put him in New York City. Three, Jason, New York City. Winner.
On paper, it sounds great.
Yeah.
So they greenlit it, and let's go.
Huge marketing campaign. Jason Takes Manhattan.
Well, the film Jason Takes Manhattan was actually shot in Vancouver, British Columbia. Under the fake titles, which they did with all these films,
yeah.
They would film it under a different title to avoid controversy, to avoid... Especially when they filmed in small places during the early years, like in
Price
Georgia
hikes,
and all
man.
That. Well, they just people would flock to
yeah.
and want to get a glimpse of Jason. So they'd call it a different name. This one they went by...
They called it Ishtar 2, so no one came anywhere near the set.
I didn't know that they were doing it because they didn't want people to flock to it or fans to flock to
they
it.
Didn't want
I thought because they didn't want local stores going, oh, big Hollywood show.
They didn't want that. They didn't want protests.
Yeah.
And they also... just wanted this veil of secrecy to keep people from wanting to snoop around and see Jason and get in the way. This one shot under two names, Ashes to Ashes. And I prefer
ashes.
The other one, Burial at Sea. The funny thing is, some of the actors didn't even know they were in a Friday 13th until shooting began.
Some of them didn't know it until after the movie was released.
No, there's a great movie about it. One of the characters, Julius the Boxer.
Really?
He's on set one day, and he's talking to one of the other actors, like, can't believe we're in a Friday 13th. He's like,
wait, what?
The name of the movie's Burial at Sea, and they're like, that's just a fake name, you idiot. We're in a Friday 13th movie. Like, oh, all right.
In a world.
I think part seven
Cohiba's
was...
making my In a World voice come along.
Part seven was Birthday Bash they filmed it under, because there was a birthday party in the screening. But it was, anyway, it was often referred to on set and then later by fans as Jason Takes Vancouver.
Vancouver.
Because there's... very little of, sadly, of New York or Manhattan or America in the finished product.
Do you like New York? Well, the budget says Vancouver.
But we'll talk a lot more about that as the movie goes on. So we start things off with the ever-present Paramount Pictures logo and the iconic...
Oh, get you ready. I like
gets it. Gets you ready. It sure does. It puts you, you know what you're getting into.
I will say that's one of the most iconic horror film sounds.
Yeah.
You hear that, you know what it is. At least if you grew up in the 80s.
But then, we cut immediately to the woods and somebody getting killed. We go to a montage of New York City, quote fingers, set to a horrible rock ballad.
It's the darkest side of the night.
The Darkest Side of the Night, performed by a horrible band called Metropolis.
Metropolis.
Is that who it was?
It's just terrible.
It's the Darkest Side of the Night.
It was like the most stereotypical 80s power anthem wannabe.
It was worse than that.
It was at this point late 80s. This was 89. And when they start flashing the graphics up on screen, you're like, oh, God.
Well, it's basically a bunch of grim alleyway shots. And seedy locations, gang members, sewer rats skimping around, gang members shooting up with sewer rats, like they're all sitting around doing drugs, like you name it.
The rat sitting there tying
the rats on
top
of the rat arms and doing drugs.
Even being a rat here sucks.
Hey, it's New York City, yeah.
But it's basically they're showing us a lot of stuff that we're going to revisit later in the film.
Yeah.
So which tells me basically they just took moments from the end of the film and
exactly.
They shot that and they're like, okay, scene two?
Yeah.
Bring it hotter.
When we'll see all these things later when we actually go to quote unquote
New
York.
York
City. I will say that certainly what we're seeing isn't today's kind of power-washed, culture-free New York City.
Yeah.
Where the most dangerous thing you'll encounter is like a long line at the Panda Express in Times Square. Like,
no, it's still very much the 80s, this yuppies.
This is before Bloomberg and Giuliani
came
in.
Up.
And I mean, but I'll get to this a little bit later, but I don't think New York was ever this bad. Like barrels of toxic waste just sitting around, manhole covers just steam shooting out.
Probably in some parts of it.
I was kind of curious as to how, because to me, as well, then again, I've never been to New York.
They make you feel really dirty just watching it.
Yeah,
I have been several times because my mom is actually from New York. So,
yeah.
And I bet when I was there was the late 80s and early 90s. So.
You shot up drugs with some sewer rats.
Me and some sewer rats go way back.
They saw you come off the bus and they knew there's fresh blood.
Exactly. Yeah, we started shooting up together.
Young man.
What I remember most was we're walking through like what was supposed to be a ritzy part of Manhattan where there's like nice stores and it was very crowded, of course. But just like in front of like the giant like Macy's or FAO Schwartz, these big department stores, there's just a homeless bum sleeping
right
in front
of it. Oh my
God,
you just described Austin. Mm-hmm.
But what's interesting is like some security guard in a suit with a walkie-talkie that's probably making a nice salary would come out and like gently nudge the guy and be like, you can't stay.
Oh, that's not Austin.
Yeah. In Austin, the guy you think's homeless is actually making $500,000 a year.
Exactly.
He's the CEO of the Macy's store.
No, he's the CEO of homeless dudes, and all the hipsters are like, oh, you poor thing. Let me donate to you.
I'm this hayseed from Central Texas. I see one of those Jamaican guys with a suitcase of fake Rolexes open, and I make the mistake of looking at it. He's like, yeah, come over here, you know? And I was like, Mom, he's selling watches for $15. She's like, you idiot. Those are...
Yes, he is.
I can attest, she did call him an idiot a lot growing up. Well, it's just a cesspool of disgustingness. But we then cut. Now we're getting to more where I'm used to. We cut to Crystal Lake.
Yeah.
Where a young, horny teenage couple, Menzies' favorite kind.
Well, I think in these movies, you just sort of accept that horny teenagers is a redundancy. I mean, they're horny.
Well,
most of them.
That was kind of my criticism of this movie, is show me more horny
teens.
More
horniness.
Yeah.
Well, we cut to a horny teenage couple, and they're partying out on a houseboat on Crystal Lake.
Which is the creakiest houseboat ever in terms of audio sounds. It was just...
And by partying, I mean they were exploring each other's inner britches. I just did it again. I used an old 1800s.
Britches?
Britches.
Great Scott.
Great Scott. I said britches again. Who am I?
Jumping Jehoshaphat.
Well, the guy, the teenage boy, drops his anchor. Not a euphemism.
Although when he says it, you kind of wonder. He's like, it's time for me to drop anchor. And you're like, oh. No. And then he literally goes
like
and drops the anchor.
So it's like dropping trowel? No, it's not. It's.
But he figures then the best way to get his baby in the mood is to put on a hockey mask, grab a knife, and
I got you good.
She goes looking for him as he drops the anchor, and he jumps out with his hockey mask and he starts stabbing her in the gut. And because she's a horrible actress, she doesn't scream or anything. She just looks at him. It's one of those knives that sinks in a prop knife, a theatrical knife.
No, I can understand that. You're in shock. You're not going to pull out the
and he sets the tone.
Jamie Lee Curtis scream.
He sets the tone by telling her, and you see they're going past the cabin.
Well, that's
by
later. That he hadn't told her about.
Yeah, he did.
I thought he did.
Yeah,
he did it before.
I know he told her later.
He gave her the backstory.
He gave her the backstory on Jason, how he drowned in the lake. But we all know.
We're right around that place where all those campers got killed.
Well,
excuse me.
Oh no, I'm sorry. He tells her the story about Jason. Then he goes and scares her.
Dresses up like Jason.
Well, after years of butchering every teenager at this camp, now he's buried at the bottom of this very lake. At the end of part 7, he was trapped under a collapsed dock, pinning him down on the bottom surface.
Where he drowned again.
And as always with these movies, the cops didn't bother going down there with scuba divers and getting the corpse, and they just leave him down there.
It's not that deep.
They just leave him down there.
He's dead at the bottom of the lake. Well, don't you think we should get his body out?
No, he's dead.
But as he's telling her the story, she's like, well, first of all, it's crazy that you'd be a teenager and just not know this story. It's a small town. You hear this.
Also, it would be crazy as a teenager when someone says, hey, oh, you remember Camp Crystal Lake? Yeah, that homicidal thing? Let's go hang out next to that.
Especially because we hear on the radio that they are part of the graduating class of Crystal Lake High School that's about to take their trip to New York. They're like, yay, that's us! He's like, you never heard of this?
Not to mention, I can understand.
Seriously, he killed 15 people last year.
I can understand in Friday the 13th 2 maybe doubting.
Yeah.
Maybe being a little suspect in Friday the 13th part 3. But by the time we get to 8, no, there's a good chance.
He's killed hundreds of people at this point in your hometown. You're going to hear about
on this very lake that you two are sailing on.
I mean, we grew up in a small town.
Are you fucking serious?
You tell me you guys never heard of the Goat Man. He was out there. He existed.
No.
Nobody's ever heard of the Goat Man.
Don't say his name 3 times.
Goat man.
Oh, you've done it. Now you've done it.
No, there's a goat man. He lived out on the outskirts of town. He had a cowbell around his neck, and he had one human leg and one goat leg.
Never heard of this.
Well, you didn't live in our...
Well, that's true. Well,
I guess not.
I did hear the ghost of Gobbler's Knob.
Yeah, I bet you did.
He's real, by the way. I met him.
Let's move on from this. Gobbler's Knob. Gobble your knob in a minute.
Sounds like a town behind the pine
curtain.
But you
can tell she's getting scared when he's telling
a story. Said by every Lufkin teenager.
You can tell she's getting really freaked out by a story, so he counters it with, oh, don't worry, Susie, they're just stories. It's like, well, you just told me he killed thousands of kids in this very lake.
And again, you've grown up in this town. How do you not know this?
She does give off an air of not being quite so bright.
Just like every horny teen in the horror flick should be.
Well, he tries to calm her down, and when that doesn't work, he just pounces on top of her, and they start going at it. But we've got the origin story now in a span of 30 seconds. We're reminded who Jason is, what he does, and that he's at the bottom of the lake.
Well, you have to, for people who haven't seen the other 6 movies.
If you don't know that he drowned as a young boy because of camp counselor's screwing and their negligence, and then his mom did a killing spree, which led to him avenging his mom, and...
yada, 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 there's 1 through 7 in a nutshell.
They give it to you.
Poor son bitch always ends up at the bottom of a lake.
Well, as they're screwing, their boat anchor drags itself right into a set of underwater power lines.
Jaws 2 style.
Jaws 2 style. That happened to be resting across Jason's body, electrocuting him like Frankenstein, and rising him...
It's go time.
It's like a huge defibrillator, just shocks his heart back into motion, and he's back at it.
Doctor, if you got shocked with a power line, would that bring you back from the dead for the 7th time?
My God, the electricity coursing through that fish-eaten corpse must just be unimaginable. But yes, Tuttle, it would.
There you have it.
I believe this is at least the 2nd time electricity has rejuvenated Jason. In part 6, someone stuck a huge metal rod into his grave and lightning hit it.
I remember that.
That zapped him back into life.
It's funny, I don't remember anything about part 6, but I do remember that scene.
Many of the Crystal Lake teens perhaps are victims of what is commonly known as the Darwin curse.
Survival of the fittest.
Like, kind of, you brought this on yourself.
Yeah. Crystal Lake could very well be Darwin's waiting room. It doesn't take a lot to get these kids.
They should change the name of the town to that. Darwin's waiting room.
That's funny.
Otherwise known as Crystal Lake.
Now Jason gets back to what he does best, slaughtering nubile teens.
Killing is my business, and business is good.
The teens hear something outside, and Jimmy goes to investigate. When he doesn't return post-haste... That's another 1800s prospector term I'll throw out there. Dadgummit. Susie heads to the cockpit of the... Is it the cockpit where the steering boat?
Not sure it's called the cockpit.
What is that?
The helm?
The helm.
The bridge.
The helm. The helm. The helm.
Come on, guys.
I'm very poorly versed in nautical terminology. I'm going to be relying on you guys a lot tonight. All of a sudden, that's when he jumps down in the hockey mask and the knife and starts stabbing her. But it's a prop knife. He takes off the mask. Oh, Susie. And they start screwing again.
She was just mesmerized by that mane of Kenny G hair that he had.
That was some awesome Kenny G
hair. She does make him promise never to scare her like that again before she spreads her legs and let's go another round. Meanwhile, a very slimy Jason is now on board, and he fortuitously finds the hockey mask just laying there. He needed that.
Yes, exactly.
And it's just his size.
Can't have Jason without
the
hockey
mask. Jason is so slimy in this movie.
He really is. They go overboard in showing how he's just dripping and
I mean,
slime.
And apparently, look in the movie, like they coated this guy in so much slime for every shot. And it looks really good on film. Like it's
It actually does.
Like,
yeah, just,
it's ooze at this point. It's like
it's kind of like the baby oil on China's body when she was wrestling. It accentuates her muscles.
Only much more disgusting.
Yeah, nobody got a boner. Really? Nobody got a boner watching Jason.
Well, nobody schmobody. Continue.
Jason. Jason once again is played by our old buddy Kane Hodder. Mincy and I had a good fortune to meet him. I think we mentioned on previous podcast. He got us both in headlocks and
a couple beers with old Kane.
Got my pregnant wife in a headlock and almost tore her head off. I'll put a picture of that.
I think y'all said that he was like one of the nicest.
Oh, he's a very cool guy, but he's a lifelong stunt man more than anything, and he's tough.
Big dude.
Not necessarily tall, but
I was a little bit big, taller than he was, but he had some cannonball biceps. The dude was huge.
I remember you saying, like, Kate, he's got U-style biceps.
He never said that. No. Tell me you never said
that. I didn't say that.
Okay. He started playing Jason in the previous entry, Part 7, and would continue the role all the way through Jason X. So he played him in 7, this one, Jason Goes to Hell.
Four movies, the only guy to ever play him more than once.
He's a top-level stuntman. He's perfect in the role. And I think when they made the move with Freddy vs. Jason and also with like Rob Zombie's Halloween to start casting these giant 7-foot stuntmen as the killers, I think it kind of took something away from... I think there's something to be said about...
He was about 6'2", Kane, so he didn't come off...
They don't need to have these huge, gigantic.
Yeah, I mean, having being a big dude, but not an outlandish.
I thought they lost kind of an element that guys like Kane brought to the role.
I'm kind of curious. Why didn't they have more than one dude previously or prior?
I just don't think it ever worked out.
And I imagine just because the films were so cheaply made that.
Was it a money thing?
Yeah. Here's a mask, put it on. And I don't think any of these stuntmen showed an interest in reprising the role.
Probably not. They probably didn't get paid a whole lot.
I mean, Kane has always been very vocal about, I want to be Jason. And so with each film, he started to develop little mannerisms to where the directors could kind of rely on him to, hey, less work for me. He knows what Jason does. Like, and he does. He is the best Jason.
Yeah, absolutely.
And he owns that role. So Jason interrupts Jim and Susie's lovemaking by shoving a spear gun through Jim's stomach, and then Susie runs, and then he traps poor Susie up on deck. What a thespian this girl was, huh? Oh, God. It's painful to watch. In the documentary and the interviews I watch her, she's very hot now, and she seems very sweet, but, God, she could not feign terror, and...
Yeah, it was
bad. It was rough.
Yeah.
He stabs her through a fake chest with a spear as well, and we fade to black. Boom, like that. Jason's back. The next morning, we find ourselves
to a bad '80s soundtrack.
We find ourselves next morning at a dock along the East Coast, as the graduating class of Crystal Lake begins to arrive at a large cruise ship,
which they foreshadowed on Jim and Susie.
It looks more like a ferry.
It does. It's like a ferry.
But it's not like a ferry like cars park on.
I know.
It's like a small, tiny
cruise
ship.
Well, what's so funny is that when you look at it, it's like a small ferry. But then once they go into it, it's got dance rooms. It's got power rooms. It's
more like
a football field.
It's more like a cruise ship, but it's smaller.
But how does a graduating class of a high school afford to take a boat?
Well, one of the graduates... Dad is the captain admiral. He probably got him a deal.
There you go. Mm-hmm. I was just kind of curious as why they were the only ones. Because, like, Lufkin used to have, like, a senior cruise to where the seniors would all go on this cruise.
This raises a couple of... Go ahead,
but,
I'm sorry.
But it wasn't, like, only the Lufkin class was on this cruise. I mean, you know...
That cruise, they all got in a Ford Explorer and went down to Papa John's.
Those were good times at Papa John's, don't
Fast
you?
Fast Eddie's.
Don't you crap.
Well, it raises a couple of interesting points. I mean, one... these are the sorts of things that the producers and writers know that the fans of Friday the 13th aren't going to ask. Cade, is it ever explicitly mentioned in the previous 7 films that Crystal Lake is in New Jersey? Because that's where it's supposed to be.
Well, here's I think I see where you're getting at.
Geographically, you could get on a boat and sail from northern New Jersey across the Hudson River, I think it's called the Lower Bay, to Manhattan.
Geographically, we're going to get in a minute where the houseboat, Jim and Sue's houseboat, floats in where the... Geographically, it's impossible for the houseboat to leave Crystal Lake and end up in this... The sound where they're leaving for New York City. And when asked about that, the filmmakers are like, well, we just needed it to show up, so we didn't figure anybody would notice.
Yeah.
Everybody would notice because you just said he was a lake.
Yeah, it's a lake. There's no outlet into a larger...
I mean,
larger...
even if it was a lake, it means it has a river, which most rivers coming from a lake are not going to have enough for a boat that size.
There's a lot of logistical plot holes.
Again, when you're watching Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, they're counting.
I'll bring up a few more just big glaring ones, and it's kind of like...
Oh, I got some huge ones.
Yeah.
I hate to get off topic, buddy, but it's a question, certainly something that you and Cody and I never experienced. In all seriousness, Todd alluded to it, the senior class trip.
Yeah.
So did you actually have something like that as seniors? We took a class trip somewhere?
I can't remember if our class did, but I know the class before us, they did have a trip down to Cozumel.
It seems like a horrible idea. We're going to take these seniors and actually take them. We're going to put them on a boat, and even if it's only going to be a half a day.
We had a senior night where a graduation night, they got all the seniors together. That sounded like a horrible idea. We had our own little get-together that day.
Yeah.
Which almost resulted in a bloodbath.
Like the project graduations and stuff like that.
I just mean, okay,
it's supposed to keep everybody sober and safe.
All right.
And we just drove by drunk, making fun of them.
Exactly.
No, but I mean, yeah, Uber. I just graduated from high school. There's not going to be any. We're not going to play any shuffleboard.
I did go to my project graduation, and you are right for making fun of them.
Oh man, we had fun that night. It was a night.
We had fun,
but y'all didn't have like a trip down to Cozumel.
Not that I was invited to.
No, none of us were.
Well, they could have had it.
On a serious note, you look at it. I mean, that's what happened to that young girl at Natalie Holloway. They went on a senior class trip to Aruba.
Aruba, and
it's like, okay, we're going to take 50 high school seniors full of hormones and wanting to drink and smoke weed, and we're going to take them from this small town that she's in Alabama to
a place where you have drinks and weed.
It would seem like even if we look at this realistically, we're going to take whatever the small graduating class of Crystal Lake High School is, 30 or 40 seniors, and put them on this boat and sail them across the Hudson to Manhattan. This seems like a really bad...
I would never let my daughters...
So many things could go wrong here.
No, I don't know. I probably would.
You know,
I would be on that trip.
You're beautiful. You're 18. Let me fund your trip to Mexico. No.
No.
They arrive at this large cruise ship for their biggest graduating class adventure. Rennie, our cute but very fragile and reserved heroine, arrives a little bit late. She's being driven by her English teacher, Miss Van Dusen. And before they join the others, the teacher gives her favorite student of all time a graduation gift. It's a sharp metal old-timey pen. Kind of like when I'm saying Great Scott, I'm usually writing with...
That was her teacher?
Yeah.
Okay, I thought that was like her mom.
No, she says this
She says you're my favorite student I've ever...
I totally missed that.
Were you drinking when you watched it?
Yeah.
Yeah, because a key plot element is that Rennie's parents are dead.
Yeah, she...
Rennie says
later her parents died.
Oh, okay. So that the dude wasn't
went off
her...
Went on the Lamisil and just degenerated.
So the dude wasn't her uncle?
No, it was
her uncle. Yeah, he was her uncle.
Oh, okay.
Her parents are dead.
And that wasn't her aunt?
No. That was her teacher, and he was her uncle and also her principal.
Okay.
We're getting to him. She gives her a pen that was supposedly used by Stephen King in high school.
In college, which is a...
Laughable that she would give that as a gift?
Well, Stephen King himself would tell you that when he graduated from college, he was about to get married, had no money, and was working as a school teacher. I doubt he saved any of his pens.
Well, she got it. And she gave it to Rennie. She's like, "You're the best student I've ever had. I want if anybody's going to make themselves in this."
Well, I just thought it was nice that you had a horror movie nod into a horror author.
By the way, Rennie,
who else were you going to do?
Rennie definitely fits the mold that's been made fun of since then.
The virginal
in Scream. She is the very cute, girl yeah. next door, but not overtly sexual, not wearing tight, revealing clothes, and like you, like you said, fragile and unsure of herself. Definitely fits that total mold of the 80s heroine.
She sure is.
You just know if anyone's going to live, it's going to be her. You know that just from seeing her at the beginning.
Well, you see, Rennie and her classmates are planning to cruise their way up the coast to Manhattan and party like it's
1989.
All under the watchful and very disapproving gaze of their principal, Charles McCullough.
Charles McCullough, the one and only. Colleen, this cruise ship was your idea. I think the least you could do is show up on time. If we establish Rennie as the cute girl next door heroine, we establish McCullough immediately as, okay, this guy's a prick.
This principal character, Mincy and I have been obsessing over this guy for years.
For fans of the show, before the show kicks off and after the show when we're, you know, taking pictures and doing that stuff, man, this guy comes up. I have never seen this movie before, but they would just, Kate and Mincy were both would just go off about this guy.
He's one of the greatest standalone characters in slasher movie history.
Without him, this
movie is unwatchable.
This is probably, it's still only a movie for the diehard fans of the series like us, but the immortal Peter Mark Richmond as Charles McCullough.
So Rennie and her teacher show up a little bit late, and he, like, Mincy, what's his line to them? He starts things off with,
"Colleen, may I remind you, this cruise ship was your idea. The least you could do is show up on time."
Immediately with the criticism. That's all this guy does is criticize
people. As soon as he delivered that line, the least you could do is show up on time. It all clicked, and I'm like, now I understand what they've been doing.
It's beautiful.
Just absolutely beautiful.
Well, Colleen, Miss Van Dusen, Colleen, tries to hide it, but you can see the pained expression on her face, like, this was my idea, and I have to spend like 48 hours on a boat with McCullough.
Somehow McCullough and I are the only chaperones on this shindig.
Why? And there's hundreds of kids on this thing at this point.
At least 50.
Or 10.
She has to deal with this smarmy, joyless motherfucker for 48 hours, and it was her idea.
Which, again, okay, if you are a principal, you're not even a teacher, you're a principal of a high school.
Yeah.
A bureaucrat.
You would think that you've got to be somebody, not a high school principal is not a bureaucrat. They've still got to be very much interested in
you chose this life.
Nurturing the teenagers. He looks like he just can't stand any of them.
He has no interest
like,
in kids.
This is a burden to him. Like,
and it gets, this will be, obviously over the course of the film, this will become very
he's bad. Equal opportunity Ooh. Critic.
I got a nice little cedar blast going there.
Let's, real quick, before we get into them setting sail, let's reintroduce cigar. I'm getting a lot of cedar.
Yeah.
I'm still heavy on the cream. The spice comes and goes.
Yeah.
But leather, cedar, and cream.
I was about to say, I'm missing the cream, but the cedar just kicked up a nice notch there.
I'm definitely getting the leather in a good way.
Yeah.
Had to relight it a couple times. That could just be because we're gabbing.
We're talking a lot. I've had to relight a lot. Also, I find with the larger ring gauges,
they take more maintenance.
Yeah. You got to stay on top of them with the lighter. But cream for me, cream, cedar, and leather.
I have to when we're dealing with a 60 gauge and even 58 gauges for a little bit. I have to chomp them down a little bit. I'm not a fan of having to chomp down a cigar to open up the draw, but the draw is actually pretty good once I got it down to a manageable size. Like I said, the cedar's coming off really nicely. It does take a little bit of maintenance. I mean, it's not something that's a light and forget cigar.
You heard it, folks, from Cade and Tuttle. On the big ones, you got to stay on top of them and you got to chomp them down.
That is right. That is right.
I'm enjoying
no
it.
No argument with physics.
Are you guys liking it?
Definitely.
I definitely agree with you. I'm picking up cedar. Cream.
Are you getting the spice kind of coming and going?
Yeah, it actually does.
It kind of keeps it interesting.
I have not tasted any spice.
Okay.
Really?
At this point, I'm barely halfway, if that. So I'm...
Yeah, I don't think any of us are halfway through this monster.
Yeah. It's a weird thing because it's difficult for me to maintain, but when it's going, it's a good smoke.
I thought you'd love it. It smokes like a powerhouse.
Yeah,
I guess I can't pinpoint cedar. I definitely get the leathery flavor, but in a good way.
I'm actually liking it. It's
doing what the larger ring gauges that I like do, where because you have that much area to play with the filler tobacco, you can kind of introduce stuff. It comes and goes. That's spice for me. It's like every 10 minutes or so, I'll be like, oh, there it is.
Yeah.
And then it'll go. But that creaminess for me is the dominant.
See, I haven't done the creaminess yet. But I actually, it was kind of, for that first third, I was kind of like, eh, I got a little bit of spice here and there. But I'm not really tasting a lot of flavor off of it. And then all of a sudden, the cedar just kind of bloomed up.
I'm getting a nice, powerful kick from it. And I've only had two beers, so.
I was going to ask, beer-wise, we all...
I'm a fan of the OPA. I will say that's an easy drinking.
The OPA rocks, and I think it's pairing really good with the cigar.
I agree. Yes. It's an easy drinking pale ale. I'm a fan of American pale ales. Apparently, I did not know that. But
still
I got
not
to thinking about
oatmeal.
It.
I'm still.
Oh,
not.
I haven't tasted oatmeal at all.
It's not. And well, that's the thing. It's not like it's, you know, hey, here's oatmeal. It's an oatmeal cookie.
Here's you a pint of Quaker Oats.
Yeah, no, it is. They specifically said you're not going to be. It's not going to give you that type of flavor where you think like, I'm tasting.
Yeah, but
oats.
I mean, I can't even taste it as an accent flavor though.
No, it's not. It's giving you more of, like I said, that grain, the nuttiness flavor.
Okay,
like,
I can see that.
I'm totally not.
But I tell you what, before my Saturday morning golf game, I'll make a bowl of oatmeal and pour some Grey Goose in it and see what happens.
Well, good on your own. The pairing is working
it's
really
good.
Well. They're playing off each other.
It's
nice.
A good pairing.
When that cedar really blossoms up, and with the pale ale, it is a very nice.
And I'll tell you what, when I do
flavor.
Get one of those spice hits in the cigar, and then I take a drink, that what hops that has really gels good with the spice. Yeah. I'm really enjoying it.
Yeah.
I think with a stout, an oatmeal stout?
No. I wouldn't do it with a stout.
I don't see that working well with the cigar.
No,
no.
That's like I said, that even though I smelled and kind of tasted like a coffee chocolate at the beginning, that's gone. So, like, if you were going to do a stout with it, I mean, I don't think it would work well.
I don't think so either.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I think the cigar lends itself to a more citrusy, subtle IPA this. It's good.
Yeah, I think subtle is the right word. If you get like a beer that's too hop tainted, that's too hop-bified, that's a technical term.
Hop-tastic.
People. Hop-tastic. Yeah, I think the hops are going to overpower the cigar.
Bitter as fuck. That's a technical term.
It's a technical term. We went to school for that.
Okay. I'll check back in here a little bit. I think, like I said, most of us are not even halfway point yet. So.
Yeah.
Which is one of the good things about...
Which is weird, because normally I'm like through.
I know, well,
that's cigar.
One of the good things about, when we get submitted the larger Vitolas, it gives you some time to really experience the cigar.
Yeah.
If it was a Robusto, you'd be done already.
I'd be done with it already, yeah.
All right, well, to get back to the movie, when McCullough sees that Colleen...
If you're going to do a podcast, the least you can do is talk about me.
We're going to do a podcast, Mr. Mincy. The least you can do is recognize my performance.
If you're going to have a beer that's got oats in it, the least you can do is actually resemble some sort of oatmeal.
Well, when he sees that Miss Van Dusen, Colleen, brought his niece Rennie along...
Dude, when this smokes, this thing just...
I told you, I thought you'd love the smoke reductions. When he sees that Rennie, his niece, came along, he goes ballistic.
His niece and McCullough is her legal guardian.
Yeah.
God, Rennie, you poor bitch.
He insists to Miss Van Dusen, you shouldn't have brought her. What is she doing here? I should have been consulted. He's always got to have the upper hand.
Miss Van Dusen's like, I think it'd be good for her.
And he's like, this discussion is over. He's like, no, I think it's just the beginning, Charles. She's standing up to Van Dusen.
That's why I thought that they were, like, married.
No. She's a teacher that works for him.
I totally missed that.
You got to quit drinking when you watch these movies. Maybe I'll pick some movies that don't require drinking.
Exactly. I knew if I was going to get...
The doctor's out.
Does it require that you not drink?
Well, he claims...
I'm out.
He claims...
What kind of podcast is this?
My last podcast.
He claims, Renee never had a balanced or stable life before she came to live with me, and I'm all she knows, and I'm what's best for her. I mean, he's very controlling of
Yeah, we'll find out about that.
But you just said that you're getting on a boat and leaving her.
Even though it's clear that Rennie is terrified of him, because she she's clinging to Miss Van Dusen. Like she's
put up with this criticism ever since her parents died.
She's clinging to her like a puppy does.
Randy, if you're going to eat those cornflakes for breakfast, at least you could do is put some 2% whole milk on them.
But exactly, if you had to live with that, you'd be clinging to anybody that was a comforting face.
Free, Renny. If you're going to buy orange juice at the... But the thing is, he kind of uses old... Like me, he kind of uses old-timey words sometimes. Like, if you're going to go down to the... Like, what's an old word for like a convenience store? Like, if you're going to go down to the
general store...
General store, get some...
If you're going to go to the trading post to buy orange concentrate, the least you can do is make sure that it's calcium fortified.
It's a very unique delivery, what was the name of the actor who plays...
Peter Mark Richmond.
The guy, he's got a very long career, but it's mainly TV.
Really?
He did a lot of old Twilight Zones.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I could see that.
But now he also had a regular role on Dynasty.
He was in Naked Gun 2.5 when...
he was one of the rich guys.
When the guy in the wheelchair, Richard Griffiths, comes out, and he's one of the rich oil producers.
But, I mean, he starred in, like, pretty much all 80s television, Love Boat... T.J. Hooker.
I was about to say, because I recognize his face
He's been in a lot of things. B.J. and the Bear. I mean, like, just pick a show from the 80s. He was in an episode. And it was just, I mean, as soon as I saw him, I was like, that's... They were going on about his voice forever.
Mincy and I have been obsessed with this guy for so long. We actually found out he had a small, like, 3 or 4 episode arc in Beverly Hills 90210.
Yeah,
in about 94.
So Mincy went back and watched on Hulu, and he subscribed to Hulu just to watch,
just the ones with
him in it.
Lawrence Carson.
Is that his character's name?
And we were hoping he'd be... Well, Cade found an ad that said he was critical of his son, Stuart.
So we were hoping it'd be this character.
Yeah, we went back and he was actually kind of cool. Like, his son's like a weenie, but he does have some good McCullough lines. But we'll get to that afterwards.
Yeah, we'll get to that. But he's just so fun to watch. So she insists. Rennie says, "You know what? I'm going on this cruise with my graduates, and that's it, Uncle Charles." And he does not like it, but we're off.
Because he's gonna do both. He does both the hype that when he gets a little agitated and raises his voice. But there's also a lot of those very sarcastic, keeps his even tone, just like that one. Like, at least you can do is show up on time. There's several of those, which are just as biting.
Yeah, they're very biting.
I love the monotone delivery.
We cut to, there's a lone ship hand on board who's mopping the poop deck. Yex? Is that the poop deck he's mopping?
I'm not sure that's accurate, but I'm going to go with
it. Just want to use the word poop.
Exactly.
When he sees...
I considered him a lot like the bartender from Bloody Valentine.
Listen to me now and hear me later. You're going to be dead. Let's go eat some taters. No, he didn't say that.
Yeah, he didn't rhyme.
He didn't rhyme like that guy. But he sees Jim and Susie's... As he's mopping, he sees Jim and Susie's houseboat glide into the dock, unmanned, with a bloody windshield from where Jason killed him. Which, again, makes no sense. It was in a lake. There's no way that could have got to where they are now.
Somehow made its way down Crystal Lake Creek and into the East River Bay.
But they had to get Jason to the party. He freaks out and he scampers off. There's always that one crazy loner in these Friday movies. That's a big Friday the 13th staple. A soothsayer, a guy who's...
Yeah.
This place is a death curse.
There's always that creepy guy that warns kids and they don't listen to him.
The eyes have foreseen it. I have warned thee.
You know, he's always the guy that warns everybody of impending danger.
Nice reference.
He warns everyone they're going to get killed, and no one ever listens to him, and he's always usually one of the first guys to get killed. I love it. At least you got him in there. It feels like a Friday 13th movie with that guy in there.
Yeah.
Also, ironically, those dudes that, you know, are warning everybody, not only are they the first ones to get killed, but they get killed bad. Like,
it's like, this is your penance for knowing something everybody else
didn't
know.
You should be aware more than anybody, but no.
You almost fucked up our narrative. You're really going to get it.
And like I said, logistically speaking, it makes no sense how that houseboat got from Crystal Lake to the Atlantic Ocean, but it did. And we'll just gloss over it like the filmmakers did.
You look down, you see a houseboat going down the highway, literally just grinding along.
Asphalt grind up. Well, we had to get him there. Meanwhile, up in the captain's, I keep saying cockpit, the bridge.
The bridge.
I think it's a bridge.
Yeah, on this one, it's a bridge.
Now it's a bridge.
The elderly, is it?
Captain Robertson.
Admiral Robertson, I believe.
They call it, it should be Admiral, but they call him Captain.
Okay, well, Captain Robertson is informing his first mate. There's two guys basically running this boat. that he's relinquishing command of the vessel SS Lazarus is the name of the boat.
Appropriately enough.
To his son, Captain Sean Robertson, a fellow graduate who's there to party with his friends, and he's also our handsome hero of the film. If there is a hero in this film. He doesn't really do a lot of heroic stuff, but he's the pretty boy hero.
He's the pretty boy male.
If there is one in this thing.
The male lead.
You can tell by the look Sean gives his buddy that he's more than uncomfortable with this passing of the baton. He doesn't want it. I don't want your life.
I don't want your life.
He doesn't say that, but he doesn't want to be a captain of this shitty boat. And when he turns over control of the boat, and he's like, looks at his son like, you're in control
turning
now.
Turning over to Captain Sean Robertson.
And take us
like,
out.
All right, let's start the engines and do pull out 180 degrees. And his dad gives him this look like, what are you doing? What's the line? Aren't you forgetting something, mister?
You've got to give the maritime signal.
Send out the international maritime signal, which is just blowing the horn. That's the international maritime signal.
In Cade's new way of antiquated talking, you know he's going to say that in the morning, like when his alarm clock goes off. Oh, God, it's the morning maritime signal.
I'm going to go into my daughter's bedroom. What are you doing? The international maritime signal's been ringing off the hook for 10 minutes.
So let me ask you this.
All my livelong days.
Tut, you recently went on a fishing trip. Can you hold your own as a helmsman?
No. I would take us straight into the nearest bank and be like, where's the beer store?
So you would say that you are not an able seaman?
I am not. I do have able seamen.
I've been waiting all day to use that one.
Well,
it just fell flat.
As soon as his dad...
had that one thought up at lunchtime today. God damn it.
As soon as the dad, the captain, realizes that, you know, his son is not playing along and his moment to, like, show off his kid is blown, Sean storms off. He runs right into the creepy deckhand who gives him the warning, this voyage is doomed.
Doomed.
He just shrugs that off and walks off.
But I was, you know, you see that one guy, it's doomed.
Why is it doomed?
Nobody ever asked these guys that.
Well,
what's going to happen and when? They never said
someone, you know, the guy that runs, I'm sorry, but.
The cards have foretold.
When an old person that has done this job, and I'm a salty deckhand who's seen everything.
He was salty.
It's doomed. Why, sir? Tell me why. What's going to happen? Well, I mean, I was not really going to, you know.
I'm sorry.
I just mean my bottle of Mad Dog is doomed. I'm going to drink it all before this vessel
totally
gets underway.
I'm unprepared for your questioning.
Well,
by the way,
because I mean, when that person walks up, you know, the guy in charge. No, everything's fine. No, we're doomed. Hey, what's that guy over there saying? He's on to something. We got to go with him.
Never give that guy credence.
You watched soap operas back in your college years in the mid-90s?
Oh, yes. Oh, Sean was a big guy.
Scott Reeves, who
plays Sean, our hero.
Married to a very hot soap star. I don't know her maiden name, Melissa Reeves, who was on Days of Our Lives and was dating the Jack Devereaux character on there for a while in the mid-90s. They're both very big soap stars.
They're big. He was a big soap guy, yeah.
I could tell with that hair.
And his performance. Well, as the International Maritime Signal blares once again, we call it a horn where I come from. The SS Lazarus. What's the difference between a USS ship and an SS ship?
I do not know.
USS would be a military ship.
USS designates military.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
What does SS stand for?
I have no idea.
What does USS stand for?
United States Service Vessel.
It's something like that, because like for the English, HMS is Her Majesty's
Service.
You're right.
What about the USS Enterprise?
United States Service.
It was a military vessel, the Enterprise? I don't know. It doesn't matter. The SS Lazarus leaves port.
Because wouldn't it be UFS? United Federation Service?
Let's not get hung up on that.
No.
Oh, God.
So they leave port.
Hey, it's a Star Trek.
It's a port.
At this point, yes, it is a port. Because they are going out, apparently, I guess, not that they're going out to international waters, but they are leaving a port from wherever Crystal Lake is connected to the ocean.
Well,
they've disembarked.
They have. Doctor? The Pooskeepy, that student loan is paying for itself.
The Poughkeepsie Institute of Technical Science.
otherwise known as the pits.
But as that ship leaves, we see at least 75 to 100 kids partying on this boat.
At least 50.
Oh, I think
40,
it's
50. No, they show a lot of them.
They show a lot.
There's a lot of they're throwing out streamers.
They're shooting and skeet with shotguns. They're throwing streamers. They're inside
and
dancing.
And I have yet to find any place that would allow a teenager to hold a gun.
There's just a ton of kids on this boat at this point. I only mention that because later on it comes into play where, like,
they're all gone.
What happened to all these kids? But at the beginning, there's easily, I would say, 75 kids on this boat. But while everyone else is having fun, as we mentioned, we join a sad Sean as he stares at this couple making out on the deck.
Wah, wah, wah.
And like clockwork, Rennie and her dog, Toby, and her crazy mid-stomach mom jeans.
Those it was the 80s. But it was the 80s. They were all like
she
that.
She was wearing the non-sexy 80s outfit.
Yeah, but this is kind
outfit.
Of... I mean, it wasn't, come up
it
to her
wasn't
boobs.
Just like it came up... To, yeah, it was like...
It's like a corset.
No, that was
a
like
sweet
that,
little
that
black vest on, though.
It's a denim corset.
It was the 80s, and you're
tops
starting
it
to,
off with a vest.
And the funny thing is, you're starting to see that those pants come back in style with the younger crowd.
Is that what we're going to say, the younger crowd?
He's talking Austin talk. They don't wear that shit around here.
Not yet. It'll take a couple of years to filter down here.
Well, he's thrilled to see Rennie show up. At least he thinks it's Rennie. She has to stretch high up and poke her face out of her jeans for him to see that it's her face. God, those are intense jeans.
They are huge.
There's obviously some kind of relationship history between Sean and Rennie, but because she's so troubled, and you get the feeling she's missed a lot of school because of her issues, we don't know what those issues are yet. But as surprised as he is to see her, he treats her with kid gloves. He's very gentle with her. He also gives her a really sweet Statue of Liberty necklace that he bought for her. It's a gold necklace with a little Statue of Liberty emblem. But their tender moment, of course, is cut short by Uncle Charles. McCullough shows up. as he's chastising them, as he does, up above them, on the very top of the ship, we see the rocker. Would this be the crow's nest, the very top of the ship?
No, the crow's nest is the lookout thing that
half this episode is like
you have no nautical knowledge.
I have no nautical knowledge.
The crow's nest goes. Never mind. Just
on the very top of the ship.
That's just an upper deck.
It's just the upper deck.
Crow's nest would be that little thing you have to climb all the way up
on
to
the, like
a tower.
On the top of the mast.
I got you. Well, a heavy metal chick is up at the top of the ship. Her name's JJ, and she's rocking out on this flying V guitar.
Her axe,
with this thick glasses wearing super dweeb named Dwayne is filming her with an
film
80s
school
VHS
deal.
Camcorder.
Just Wayne.
What did I say? Dwayne?
Dwayne, no, yeah.
It's Wayne.
It's Wayne.
Wayne is filming her with this 80s camcorder, and she's not actually playing. She has a boombox that plays it. She just is mocking this music video.
I think she's playing through it.
The drum and the backup. She's playing her axe.
Well, and I will say this for the actress who does play her, she does know guitar.
She thrashes.
Yeah, well, I mean, her movements, obviously, I don't know if she was actually playing, but her movements did mimic what was going on.
Gives you a little Joan Jett and the Blackhearts there?
Yeah, I was actually surprised at it, because normally when you get these little low-budget actresses or whatever,
it's like me,
it's just like, yeah, you're bar courting when you're doing a solo shred. Yeah. But right, no, well, she actually held her axe.
She's very serious about her heavy metal music, and she wants to go down the ship's engine room to film a radical music video.
Because there's Boss Acoustics down there.
There's Boss Acoustics down there. And he says, you know what, I'll help you, but I got to go help popular girl Tamara film some stuff first. JJ warns him, you know, don't be a dweeb, don't do Tamara's bidding, she's the popular girl, she doesn't care about you. But you can tell he thinks he's got a shot with this chick.
He put on his best long sleeve Chess King shirt to
all the clothes
get after that ass.
Well, we go back down to Principal McCullough. He's now practically begging his niece Rennie to go back to shore. I can turn the vessel around right now, we can get you back safe. He says it's simply not safe for her to be on the ship.
Why not?
She says...
Because he's on it? That's why it's not safe? I'm here, Rennie. This isn't safe for you.
Well, she says, you know what, Uncle Charles? I can't remember where my problem started. Those mom jeans
foreshadowing!
The mom jeans might be a good start. Or why she's so afraid of the water. She gives us that.
Foreshadowing!
So she has issues with the water. But, you know what? Maybe this is good for me. And then, you know, he says, well... You know, Rennie, sometimes facing your fears doesn't mean you're going to conquer them. Thanks, Uncle Charles.
That was the exact opposite of every psychological profile ever.
Great advice.
You should face your fears.
Face your fears, Rennie.
Well, there's a reason we learn he doesn't want her to face her fears. He's the root of them all, but we'll learn that later.
But alas, you just spoiled the entire podcast. Let me give you out the links here.
Okay. She's staying, and she's not going anywhere, she tells him. Back at her room, port side.
That's the left side.
Port side?
Hey, you know what?
Again, was it on the left?
Don't stop and look for confirmation.
Just act like I know what I'm saying.
Just go back in a room port side and keep going. You're like, back in a room port side. And you like look around at us, but like, was I right? Just go with it. Back in the forecastle.
Okay, hold on. So back at a room port side.
See?
No, he did it.
I did it. Rennie sees a hallucination out her window of a young boy drowning outside her window. Those little round windows.
He's not drowning outside the window. He's drowning in the window.
Yeah, he's like in the window. He's like tapping.
And this is at this point where like there's nothing to like clue you in as what this is.
Who
about.
Is this kid? What's going on? It's a little boy banging on her window. Well, underwater.
If you're a fan of the series, you obviously know what it is.
At a certain point, you're going to allude. Oh, it's Jason. But at this point, it's just a little kid.
Yeah.
Outer window.
Again, the touch point. If you're a fan of the series,
by this time you're watching the eighth movie, you're pretty much the only people watching this are fans of the series.
But still,
it's horrible storytelling.
Yes, it's just like. And I was like, wait, there's no context for this.
Yeah,
you created a standalone story.
Previously in the other Friday the 13th, have they ever done this like flashback, mystical kind of stuff?
No.
Not so much flashbacks.
No. We've always gotten flashbacks maybe to him drowning, but not where a character actually sees it in a hallucination. Yeah,
right. I'm wondering if this was kind of an influence of the Nightmare on Elm Street competition that started kicking
in. It could
be.
Possibly. It was also... I would learn there's a real concerted effort in this film to be a bookend to the first one. If he was going to kill Jason, let's take him back to what started all this,
which was the drowning
in the lake. But she sees this boy tapping on her glass, and as she makes her way over to him, all of a sudden her dog jumps off the bed and runs away.
Yeah, dog was like, I saw that shit, and I don't want any part of this.
Yeah, dog runs actually away. Like panning over to the dog, and the dog's staring at it like, holy shit. Like, really?
So
the dog can see this?
The boy disappears, and she runs after the dog.
Turns out it was a real little kid drowning. She's like, fuck this. I got to do it with my uncle. She just draws
And I'm on the fifth story of this boat, so there's no water out there. This sucks.
That was another... she should have maybe picked up, maybe I'm crazy. Meanwhile, upstairs, the super popular blonde vixen, Tamara, who JJ was speaking of earlier...
Good-looking girl, Tamara.
And her Asian sidekick, Eva...
Kelly Hugh.
Don't do the who's on first routine.
Sorry. It's worth a shot.
Went on to a long career.
Of X-Men fame.
Another good-looking girl.
Yeah, she doesn't really do a lot in
Actually
this.
Actually got a lot sexier she aged.
Yeah. She looked like a teenager. She's one of the few that actually looked like a teenager. A lot of the characters in this looked... Easily.
I believe Rennie was the only one that was actually... She was like 19 when they shot it.
Looks 28.
Yeah.
Okay, well, Tamara and her...
She's still cute, though.
Tamara and her Asian sidekick, Eva, Kelly Hugh, are watching... they're up above, watching down beneath. Stud boxer Julius pummels some other jock type in a boxing match. Tamara's admiring Julius's body. She's like, you know, he's the only... senior guy I'd even consider doing. You know, she likes college dudes and deckhands, apparently, because all of a sudden another deckhand walks by. Not the creepy guy.
No, he's
guy,
the studly guy.
The stud
walks
guy.
By the tool belt.
Yeah. Yeah. Kind of Young Mincy-esque.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't mean the way he looked, just his lascivious stares toward the teenagers.
Well, he's very flirtatious with these minors. And
you can see what I can do. You can see what I can do with this 9/16 wrench.
Mincy... 2,000 steel reserves ago, deckhand.
That hurts. 1,000.
1,000 steel reserves. nice.
God, it probably has been 2,000. Continue.
Well, he kind of runs by, and they kind of flirt with him a little bit, and it's clear that Eva, Kelly Hugh, just kind of is following Tamara's lead. She's the big girl on campus. And,
yeah.
Principal McCullough now bumps into JJ... the dorky videographer as he's storming around the ship looking for Rennie. Wayne. Oh, yeah, you're right. Sorry. JJ's the girl.
JJ's the girl.
Sorry. It seems that senior predictions have begun down in the main ballroom, and Rennie isn't present. And
where's Rennie? Worried. Well, I don't know. Well, I'm a little bit worried. Senior predictions started 5 minutes ago, and she's not there. Well, maybe some of us don't want our predictions told. In your case, I'm sure that's true.
That was such an awesome line, actually.
You're his principal! Why are you doing this if you hate these kids so much? It is a great line.
Hell yeah. Actually, his delivery, too.
In your case,
I'm sure that's probably true.
True.
Such an asshole.
As a kid, like, you're still dejected. He's like, he's probably right.
No, he's right.
He's right. I'm a fucking loser.
Well, it turns out Rennie's up on the poop deck looking for her dog, Toby, when she stumbles across Tamara and Eva snorting blow off a mirror.
Nobody's going to catch us here.
No, nobody's going to look for us here out in the wide open under the moonlight. So they offer Rennie a snort of cocaine, and she declines. She's like, have you seen my dog? They're like, no. So that's that. But then soon
she's
after,
probably going to narc on us.
Yeah. McCullough stumbles across them, and they assume that Rennie snitched. They think that Rennie told her uncle that they were doing drugs. They're going to get her back. McCullough tells Tamara that he'll meet her in her stateroom in 15 minutes to review her biology report, or else you'll be stuck aboard this vessel while your friends are seeing the sights.
They're supposed to do reports on this trip?
Apparently, when one gets Tamara, the slutty chick has not turned in her biology report. And if there's one thing McCullough can't stand, it is when you have gotten on the senior class trip and you have not turned in your biology report.
There is hell to
pay. So he's going to be down there to check her paperwork.
He Mincy style.
In a weird McCullough movie, he overlooks the broken mirror with cocaine all over it. Were you doing illicit drugs? And they're like, no. Well, I'll be in your stateroom. That's another weird. Who calls it that? A stateroom?
I'll be heading fore and aft of the stern to go. Just throw it
out. Actually, I think I used that the other day to my daughter. I'll be in your stateroom to wish you a fond good night.
Great Scott.
Great Scott. Where's my whiskey? We cut down in the sauna. The boxer that got the shit beat out of him by Julius is now laying down to recover. He's put a towel over his face. He's pretty sore. And Jason enters the steam room and grabs one of the scalding hot, you know, rocks in the sauna and just pushes it right through the dude's chest cavity and basically just implants it.
Shoves a hot burning rock into his chest.
We don't see it. This movie suffered horribly. This is when the MPAA, the ratings board, was just hammering down on these films. I mean, the level of gore that they went through to really show some great kills.
Yeah.
You don't see any
of it. Yeah, like Tut pointed out, too, is a lack of cleavage. It's a very soft R.
Yeah, very soft. I mean you see the side boob of the girl in the opening scene, the Jim and Susie scene.
Yeah.
You see the girl, Tamara, a little bit later in the shower, a little bit naked, but that's it.
That's it,
You don't really get any good TNA. You don't get any really gory... that opening scene with Jim and Susie, it was originally shot where you see that spear gun go into Jim, pull out his guts. Like, that footage was shot. I've seen it.
Yeah.
But they were like, nope, nothing.
Wow.
It's a very... The girl who plays Rennie, Jensen
Daggett.
She's like, you know, we kind of refer to it as the Disney Friday the 13th movie because it was very tame for,
laid back,
for what they'd got away with in the past. So Jason kills this guy. Then we go up top on board. Snitches indeed get stitches. Because Tamara walks over to Rennie and just shoulder rolls her over the side of the boat. Knocks her into the ocean. In front of everybody. And like, oops. Did I do that?
Did I do that?
And Rennie's just down there. She can't swim. She's terrified of the water. She's flopping around. The same little kid that she saw in her hallucination at her window is all of a sudden under the water pulling her down. This little kid, you know, is she imagining this? Is it real? What's going on? Yeah. Just in the nick of time, Rennie's confidant, Sean, jumps over the side and rescues her.
Ruins a good 80s leather brown jacket, too, in the process. He doesn't take that off. He just goes full throttle.
Well, how just the weight of those mom jeans when they're soaked with water? It would take the strength of 10 men to pull her out.
I think it would have the opposite effect. I think it would have ballooned up and some sort of flotation device.
I think the denim vest she had acted as a flotation device. My gosh, she wore so many clothes in this. Sean rescues her. Miss Van Dusen throws over a life preserver. Helps out too.
Which really is grab the life preserver. When they shoot down again, the preserver's like 20 feet away from her. Like, where did you throw the?
I can't throw very good. I'm a history teacher.
All of a sudden, McCullough's there. Nice toss, Colleen.
Nice toss, Dwight Gooden.
All of a sudden, when she's back up on deck, McCullough does show up. They're trying to tower off, and he pushes everyone. Give me those towels.
Give me those towels. What's going on here?
I'll dispense with the linens.
She's fine. I'll dispense with the linens. She's fine. No thanks to the two of you. They just tried to save her.
Yeah, he's like, no thanks to the two of you. I'm here now.
Actually, she is fine because of the two of them. She's fine, not thanks to the two of you.
I'm in charge now. Well, Uncle Charles shuffles Rennie away. And as they're going, they run into the creepy old deckhand. He doesn't mince words now. He's straight up, he's come back, and you're all going to die. So he's getting a little more specific in what's going on.
Well, you know, and I can't quite figure out at this point, because it really bothered me. Like, at this, after that, I was like, wait a second. Well, if you know, like, Jason is everywhere, why, you see him on, like a lifeboat, you suckers, I'm out of here. I mean, he would have been, like, gone, like, 20 minutes ago.
No, I know this voyage is doomed, so I'm going to sit here and wait for my ultimate end.
I think it would be funny if you had seen Jason on the lifeboat paddling away. Fuck this.
You can't take McCullough anymore.
This guy's a jerk.
Way to paddle, serial killer.
Nice hockey mask, Eddie Balfour.
I think we're all...
Yeah, nice reference. Nice reference.
Very nice reference.
By the way, this is...
We're about halfway through the cigar at this point. Well into the beers. How are we feeling? I'm just still getting... You guys have not picked up any of the cream? This thing is a cream machine for me.
Not to me.
Cream, spice, occasional spice, and just tons of cedar and leather.
Cream machine was Cade's nickname in college.
Well...
At most of the fraternity houses.
Is it sorority or fraternity?
Fraternity.
Okay, yeah, you're right. I'm liking it. I will say this. The larger ring gauge, it's taking some maintenance.
It really is.
I've used about 3-4 pounds of butane to keep this sucker going. But we are talking a lot. But also with larger ring gauges, you have to... I mean, it's like a campfire. You got to keep it... You got to keep that fire
stoked.
Going. The bigger it is, you got to work it. That's what the ladies tell me.
That's what they don't tell them.
But I've that cream that I told you guys on the initial blast, I'm still getting it with the incoming spice and all that. But man, that cedar and leather and that creaminess, and like you said, a little bit of the coffee. To me, it's a large ring gauge done right. I'm getting a lot of flavors. It's not a one note cigar for me.
No, but I'm definitely getting more of the leather, the cedar. I'm missing out on the cream. Also, the strength's kicked up in it. Of course, it might be the copious amount of alcohol I've been drinking as well.
Sure. I felt it pretty strong throughout. I'm not. There's an overwhelming leather for me. I'm not getting the cream flavor, but
it's smoking
maybe it's just
like
I don't have the palate.
It's
perhaps.
Smoking like a. House fire.
I mean, I was about to say when it.
Who said that over there? Is that Cade?
When it's when it's drawing and it's a beautiful smoke when it's drawing. Yeah, when you got it lit up and it's nice, it's a really good cigar.
What I like about it in this size, a 6x60. I mean, we're two. Granted, we didn't light up till close to the hour, so we're about an hour into this.
Yeah,
it's still got a ways to go, but like I said. Don't give me a boring cigar. This sucker's not boring. It's giving me a lot of different stuff.
Agreed.
And I was really kind of curious about with the Cohiba brand itself, because there's some interesting connotations with Cohiba. It's a very popular name. It's a very popular brand. You got the Cuban connotation with it. But it's also a very counterfeit cigar as well. So
On the Cuban side. It's one of those top tier names,
right?
Monte Cristo, Cohiba, Punch,
right? It's a top tier name, and I've had some of the counterfeits as well. I've had some of the real things as well, and it's kind of one of those cigars that when you get the real thing, it's really good cigar. When you get the counterfeits, it's not so good cigar. So a lot of times, a lot of people will have that counterfeit in mind when they're actually doing it.
But I think we got to separate that because that's all the Cuban side.
Right.
I think I haven't smoked a lot of the Dominican Cuban. They call them the red dots. If you look, label, the anything non-Cuban will have a red dot on the O in Cohiba.
I had a real. So has everybody here had a real? Authentic Cuban Cohiba?
Yeah.
Yes.
So the only time I had one, we talk about giving cigars away. This is about 15 years ago when I was living in Irving. A guy had a shop, just Cigar World, but it was just a privately owned shop. And I used to go in there every week, and the guy gave me a I think it was a Churchill. It was a long bat. And he said, I'm not going to charge you for this one. I'd been coming in every week. He's like, this is from across the water. And I was like, oh, okay. He's like, so there, go ahead and take it home. And I was like, Jesus, thanks.
Camp Crystal Lake.
it's from the East River.
If you're going to give me a cigar.
Going to give me a Cuban cigar, the least it could do is have one of Castro's manifestos on it. I wasn't drinking anything, and I felt like I had smoked dope. I was just buzzing like a hornet after I'd gone through that thing.
Oh, that Cuban soil and that nicotine content is a unique thing that you don't get.
Yeah, that's really. One thing with the Cubans is that you get a little dialed up strength in there. That's kind of a nice little punch.
I have noticed once I hit the midway point, I am having to less maintenance on it, keeping it burning. It seems to be burning pretty well on its own by now. Like a good campfire, it gets going. It's kind of good. I'm curious to see. I'm halfway in. I want to see where this thing goes. But man, to give me a cigar like this, it's going to last me 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
And not be the same note all the way through.
Yeah. And it's got a lot of flavor to it. It's a nice, flavorful cigar. I really appreciate that.
It is. And I am getting a little bit. You got a little way. You're still kind of a little behind.
Yeah.
Midway point, I'm curious, because I think you pick up on this note a lot more than some of us do, but I'm getting like a citrus, a little bit of like an orange peel, like a little citrus to it too. Let me know if you get that later.
Okay.
On.
Yeah, totally missing out on that one.
I like it. So Rennie goes into the bathroom of the ship. Yax, is that right? The bathroom?
Yes.
They call it the head.
Called a bathroom.
No, it's called the head.
She goes into the head, and the sink water, as she's washing her hands, turns blood red. And the little bastard that's been pestering her from the water breaks through the mirror and tries to grab her. Now, at this point, most folks, I think, are assuming it's young Jason.
Yeah.
You have to.
Or that Rennie has got a severe psychological break in reality.
Both. I think you know it's Jason, you know that it's in her head.
And I'm just kind of...
Clearly, a little boy is not coming through the mirror... Because there's never been a supernatural element to these films.
And I think that's what's actually kind of lost me, is that, first of all, I'm not a fan of the genre to begin with, but...
Does it do... I guess that was my question. Do these little Jason moments of kid Jason do anything for you guys?
No, they don't.
Because they do it for me.
They don't.
It's a good point that you bring up, other than...
It's not scary. It doesn't look good. It doesn't move the plot point at all.
Other than Jason's regenerative ability, which is the same thing you have with any of them, with Michael Myers, there wasn't any sort of supernatural hallucinogenic
stuff. Now, granted, in Part 7, he did face off. There was a teenage girl that had telekinesis, could move things with her mind, but that wasn't Jason's... supernatural. That was, they were trying to bring in a Carrie type, different type of foe for him.
Yeah,
but this is just so foreign to the.
It didn't do anything for me.
You
it
get
really
to part 7 and part 8, you got to throw a few rolls of the dice.
Well, that's what they're doing here. They're just going for broke. But it did nothing for me from a plot standpoint. It was more annoying.
Yeah, these were my least favorite scenes
especially
of the entire
it wasn't
movie.
Scary.
No, it wasn't.
Well, it didn't.
It's a horror movie. It should.
It jumped out at you, but it didn't come around. It wasn't like.
Nothing in this movie is scary.
If there's going to be hallucinations, this should at least be the ingestion of some psychedelic mushrooms.
Well, what I love about doing horror movies on the show is because I know Tut watches these films on his iPad out in the dark deck of his house.
Yeah.
I like to, when I watch these films, I'm like, oh, Tut just jumped out of his seat there. There's nothing in this film that's going to make him scared or jump.
Yeah, there really wasn't.
And that's a huge... I'll get to this later, but that's been
at least
in the best of these movies, there are jump scares.
Yeah.
There are moments where Jason comes out of nowhere. everything is either foreshadowed.
It wasn't.
Or with this kid. It was just flat.
Yeah.
Poorly done horror film.
I mean, at least like when we did the October series where we're running through like the Houses of October built and all those scary movies doing our Halloween festival thing. There was some times in that run of movies to where, you know, I had some really good scary moments, and this didn't deliver any of them.
What's the and house that October
and I,
built?
And I knew it would.
It was
like
Yankee Stadium with Reggie Jackson.
Pretty much. It wasn't the house that Jason built, unfortunately, because it just failed. And then when you remove the TNA element and when you remove the gore and the slasher elements,
you're not
what are you left with?
Well, you're left with Principal McCullough.
Pretty much.
I'm just waiting for him to come on scene and make me laugh.
It kind of is.
Give us more McCullough.
It kind of is.
It's like needs more cowbell.
Need more McCullough.
And to be honest, I mean, even from an outside looking in, that's kind of sad for the series.
It is. And that's why, I'll get to that, but that's why this was basically the nail in the coffin for the series.
And I'm really kind of curious as to why y'all chose this movie.
I'll get to that.
Okay.
Meanwhile,
McCullough.
In Tamara's, Tamara, in her stateroom.
It's like Braveheart.
McCullough! Mendoza! McCullough! In her stateroom, Principal McCullough drops in to check her biology report.
On Tamara.
And
she's got her biology report ready to go.
She's dressed in only a silk robe.
Now we're talking.
And she offers Charles a glass of champagne. Where did you get this?
I brought it on board.
I packed it for us, Charles. What? He's very confounded. He plays it very comical. What? So she gives him the champagne.
If you're going to bring champagne on board, the least you could do is provide me with a bit of vintage.
Well, she stands up and she drops her robe off. And she's standing there in some lingerie, and she's drawn some internal organs on her body. Stomach, go up to the heart. She's drawn all these things. That's her biology report.
Too bad she didn't have one that said McCullough's penis goes here. Point.
Well, she'd like to make sure McCullough, you know, make sure I didn't forget any that she drew on herself, she says. What do you think you're doing? I'm your teacher. His voice gets kind of high and uncomfortable. But before he can do anything, she pounces on top of him, pulls him down onto the bed. And starts kissing him. It takes him a very long time to shake free of this.
It's a pretty lame fight up.
Did you guys notice at one point you see him, he kind of just raises her ass cheek.
While
get off me, please.
I'm resisting.
He's a tall guy. He could easily.
While I'm here.
No, get off me.
Yeah, he stroked her ass for a couple seconds.
This is wrong.
But once he stands up and's kind of straightening up his blazer and whatnot, you know, he's this is unacceptable. JJ, the video.
Wayne.
Wayne, I keep calling him JJ.
JJ at this point has been killed by Jason.
No, not yet.
Yeah.
She was one of the first ones to go.
Yeah. She really goes was. Down, you she missed,
what?
You missed
may,
that kill.
I may have totally glossed
you,
over that
you
kill.
Glossed over
JJ,
the
heavy metal chick, was down in the engine room, and Jason grabbed her guitar and beat her over the head with it. He axed her with her axe.
Oh,
again,
hey.
We saw no blood. We saw no.
It was very forgivable. Totally forgettable kill.
Well, yeah, I forgot about it. It's the definition of forgettable.
Exactly.
And that was one of those ones. It was like that first one, the real.
This is supposed to set the tone.
Yes, yeah, one of the first kills.
And like you just said, it's just completely forgettable.
Yeah.
And it should have been awesome because it was. That kind of that first kill, her down in the engine room, fleeing from him, and then he just appears. But he appears and he has her guitar. Where did he get the guitar from?
Yeah, it was.
I mean, it just
turns out Jason's a big Rat and Poison fan, and he was really angry the direction JJ was going in.
Well, Wayne emerges into from the doorway of the bedroom. He's been recording this whole sexual tryst
because he loves Tamara,
and
he's recording McCullough not fight off too harshly.
He catches that little cup of the butt cheek and, what are you doing here, you dweeb? Well, he doesn't say that, but he's like, he takes out the VHS tape from the camcorder and throws it to Tamara, and she's like, you know what, I will be graduating, and she's got him by the balls. She's like, if you don't want this tape
blackmail.
To be seen, I think we'll all be just fine. You will be repeating your 12th grade year, the young lady.
And you can forget any ideas you have of getting into film school.
Ever. And she's like, he storms off. She's like, Wayne, don't worry about it. he's not going to try anything.
Hey,
so Wayne's like, since I'm here, he grabs McCullough's champagne. He's like, he chooses this opportunity to tell Tamara, you know, I've always kind of had the hots for you.
I've always had the hots for you.
And she basically tells him to pound sand. She's done with him and get lost.
Wayne, you look like the... Well, you just look like Velma from Scooby-Doo. Let's just call it what it is.
Well...
Hey, Velma was hot.
She has to shower.
Oh, crap. Does that mean Wayne's
hot?
Oh,
boy.
Oh, that's she has to shower to get all this drawings of internal organs off her body.
That opened up some stuff.
And yet, once again, we saw nothing.
No, nothing. We see nothing while she's in the shower. Although Jason does, after she's done showering, he breaks into a room.
She had to wash some McCullough off of her. She's like, God, I'm getting very sarcastic all of a sudden.
There is, I should say this, there is a funny moment in the documentary, which I'll kind of fill you in on later. A great documentary on the entire Friday series. But they interview the actor playing McCullough. He's like, well, I couldn't help but get aroused. So yeah, he totally got a boner during that scene. She was quite... He's a very goofy kind of guy in real life. It was kind of refreshing. He didn't talk like... He still talked like that in real life, but he was a little more free and easy about it. Anyway, she's showering. Jason comes in, throws her into the bathroom mirror, naked. But
well, again, he grabs at her and then derobes her as he... I guess the force of his grab knocks her in across the bathroom, and she kind of falls out of her robe.
Knocks her head through the glass, breaks the glass.
At this point, I'm like, oh, the robe is off. Oh, you're not going to show me anything.
He then takes some shards of glass that she broke and stabs her with it. Again, originally it was like 50 pieces of glass he stuck in her body.
Yeah.
But we just see him just hit her once and we're... Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And we're done.
He basically just takes a shard of mirror and treats it like a
machete.
That's
what we see, but it was much more graphic, but no, he just kills
her. And again, it shows nothing. It's
well,
her,
you know what?
Cowered in the corner for 5 minutes.
A lot of people blame Jason fatigue at this point on the decrease in interest in these movies and the decline in the box office. I think people may, more than Jason fatigue, getting tired of him. If you would handle them with some skill and some actual... You know, quality filmmaking. I think they're more in, and they were just tired of lazy, boring filmmaking.
And it was lazy, boring filmmaking. There was no suspense at all.
There's so many kills throughout this film, including Tamara's we just talked about, where you see Jason open the door handle, grab a weapon. There's no like, oh shit, it's Jason, and he's there.
Yeah,
we see every move he makes. There's no suspense.
Yeah, there's no suspense at all.
We see him before any of his victims do. We
know
what's
coming. There's no shot down a long, dark, empty hallway with that.
Absolutely none. And the early entries did it well.
Yeah,
but they just there's no suspense.
There was no wide open shot of an empty forest with that. Kill.
No, with the Halloweens always never abandon with that element of surprise with Myers. There's just none of that here.
You know, as much as I bitch about jump scares, I kind of missed them. I totally missed them. I was like, I wanted at least one jump scare. It was absent.
There's a mistake here due to the limitations of the budget, which I'm going to get to a little bit later on. But the fact that when you're on a ship, even a big one, once you're in the interior of it, it's very claustrophobic.
Yeah.
But so
that's a good point.
A skilled guy like John Carpenter... That house in Halloween, when he gets in there with the kids and with Jamie Lee Curtis, he could be around. It's a house. It's
it could
much
be
smaller
around
than
any corner.
Ship. It is the definition of claustrophobia. He could be around any corner. Those
but
shots
never
of
got,
him emerging from the darkness.
But I never got that sense with this movie at all.
There's none of that here. It's just big slimy Jason lumbering around, and we see him more than any other character in this film.
Yeah.
We're with him every step of the way, and it's not scary, and ultimately it's not entertaining.
I agree.
Well, not only that, I mean, and the main
just
thing
is, just a little bit less of Jason would have gone a long way in this movie.
Because of the size of the ship, at this point, the way that they made it feel like this is a cruise ship with 5 people on board.
It kind of was, yeah.
So, like, he's...
What happened
like
to the 300 students
around? If he encounters someone, he kills them.
I would have climbed
but
up to the crow's
nest. But these people are just walking all over this giant
ship. Well,
that one guy tries. It didn't.
Yeah, didn't go over him.
He's just going all over this giant cruise ship. I mean, if he just... He's so lonely at this
it's
point.
Just,
like,
it's just...
you can just tell Jason's looking around. There's nobody here to kill. You know he's like opening doors and like,
Nobody here.
Just he's dejected. Half
he was
the
going
time.
In Tamara's state room to whack off. He didn't know she was there.
No, he's like, you know what? This used to be like a challenge.
Exactly.
It's shooting fish in a barrel at this
exactly.
point. I mean, it's not even that. It's beyond easy for him, and it's boring to us to watch him do it, especially when there's no gore involved.
No.
Well, Jason takes next out Sean's dad, the admiral or the captain or whatever he is. And his first mate with a harpoon. And again, you see him grab the harpoon off the wall. You see him walk up to them and kill them. You could have played that suspenseful. What is
bad.
That sound? Every other movie. What's that sound? They go and then...
Don't go into there!
All of a sudden, Jason jumps up. No.
Yeah, it's very PG-13 by today's standards.
Well, when Sean and Rennie discover his dad and the first mate's bodies... they get on the intercom and they call everybody to report immediately to the bridge.
At which point now there's only 6 people instead of 30.
Well, yeah, 4 or 5 people show up. McCullough barges in. I demand to know what's going on. I'm still in charge here. And a second later, the creepy deckhand pops up in the the captain's thing. And,
you're all doomed.
Like I said, the minute you know.
Well, finally he says. Finally, the deckhand says Jason. Because he's been alluding to he's back. Finally, he's like, Jason's back and he's going to kill everybody.
Jason Voorhees.
Well, there's only one person here that...
Jason Voorhees has been dead for years.
McCullough snaps at this point. He grabs a knife and he's going to kill the deckhand. Miss Van Dusen like grabs McCullough like, Charles, get a hold of yourself. He's the only...
I haven't got tenure yet.
So she stops him and the little guy runs away. As the principal once again reminds the kids he's in charge, Julius, the boxer, shows up.
That's when he reminds them. When Julius comes
yeah,
in.
Yeah, Julius is like, all right, you guys come with me. We're going to get this guy.
Wait a minute. I'm in charge here. He's all, school's out, McCullough.
Which I always thought, before I watched it again, would be much cooler. I always thought he said, school's out, motherfucker.
That's what I kind of thought he was. I thought he did say, yeah. But then I realized he didn't.
These motherfuckers right here are dead.
It would have been much...
I'm in charge here. You don't do no such thing.
You're in charge of nothing. School's out,
McCullough.
Motherfucker. But yeah. He says McCullough. And I always thought it was motherfucker, but because I have a 2-week-old infant, I had to watch this with the subtitles on to keep the volume low. And sure enough, it was...
School's out, McCullough. Ah, come on.
So now Julius is leading the pack of remaining dudes to hunt down Jason, and this drives McCullough nuts. He's not in charge anymore. Next thing we see is Rennie out in the rain trying to drop the anchor of the ship because Sean says they need to drop anchor. She's got like a little wrench and she's like turning it on this little thing that's going to somehow...
Well, I mean, you know...
What is that thing? A little thing you spin?
It's like the manual drop.
It's like what you take tires off with. Like a
wrench.
A ratchet.
But this movement isn't going to drop a giant...
But she does it forever.
But then McCullough goes into critical hyper overdrive. Do you think dropping an anchor in a storm is a good idea?
Thanks, Jacques Cousteau. Why are you listening to Sean? I'm in charge here.
I'm an authority here.
Well, meanwhile, down the ballroom, Tamara's sidekick, Eva, is cornered by Jason, the dance hall where they're doing the dance and stuff.
Anybody besides me notice that in that dance hall, there's a full bar in the background?
Yes, I did.
These are teenagers on there. They've got like this full bar with all these whiskey bottles back there.
And I'm trying to figure out at this point, because also, she runs into the dance hall.
Now I know where the TNCC group would be.
She runs into the dance hall.
They find
hall.
Us a year later, she preserved stands, underwater.
She runs through one set of doors. She runs into the dance hall, and then she's on the dance hall like confused, doing circles, looking around.
There's mirrors there. Well, it was confusing.
No, here's the thing.
Now, dude, go back to that. We're the violin quartet from the Titanic. The ship's going down. We're just still sitting there drinking.
Well, here's the thing. And this
carry on, guys.
This really exemplifies perfectly what's wrong with Jason in this movie. She's in this room, standing in the middle of the room. From me to you, you're Jason. She's looking at him. And all of a sudden, he disappears. And she looks over here, and he's right here. Jason was never this ghostly figure that could disappear and reappear.
He was just a remorseless killing
now,
machine.
Granted, you could run and he could walk and he'd catch up with
there
you.
There was always a Myers element to that, too.
But that was when you stopped and caught your breath. They always kind of gave you that...
Yeah.
No, She's literally looking at him, and he disappears, and then she looks, and then he appears somewhere else.
She runs,
and they do this like throughout the rest of the film, and it drives me
bananas. She runs, but my problem was is she runs in to the dance floor, to the middle of the dance floor. She's doing these circles around her with the camera, and like you know, she doesn't know where to go. But you look around at there's literally like three other doors to run from Jason. Like, go out that door.
Well, starting with Jim in the opening scene, there's a lot of kills here where the people just immediately give up.
Yeah, they just kind of sit down and cower.
Wait for it. Like, yeah. They're young kids. They could easily turn around and run, but they don't.
I'm like, you know what? At this point, and if anyone were to say, like, Jason's afraid of water, so all I have to do is jump off the boat into the water and Jason won't follow me?
Well, clearly Jason's not afraid of water.
No, because he's soaked in it the entire movie.
And we'll get to it.
Well, he spent months at a time in it underground.
Yeah, that's true. It,
but I'm like...
He faced his fears.
Especially for the kill with Eva, there's like literally three other sets of doors all around.
Yeah.
They're not bolted. They're not blocked. She could just have just kept running.
Well, they don't do that.
Instead, he comes out and just...
Interesting note, Kane says this kill scene was his favorite in the entire film.
Really?
The reason being was, what was the actress's name?
Kelly Hu.
Kelly who?
Don't.
He had to lift her up by her neck, like he did Mincy and I at Texas Frightmare Weekend, and physically
We were a lot heavier.
He had to throw her down, and he actually did this to the actress. She had to hit that ground without breaking her fall at all. Like when he tossed her down and they had to do one take, she had to completely play it to where
she was dead.
You believed that when she hit the ground, she broke every bone in her body upon impact.
Yeah.
And it does sell very well. Yes. Because literally, it's just a toss and you're dead. And he's like, yeah, he's like, it was a really tough stunt to do because you're dealing with a fragile young actress. And I'm violently tossing her down, and there's no padding.
There's no mat, yeah.
And he's like, that was, you know, he's kind of a sadistic dude. He's like, that was a fun one. And I could not find any record of Kelly Hu commenting on this film. I don't think she's too proud of that. Although, there was one quote. She's like, I thought I was going to be Jason in Manhattan, but I spent a month in Vancouver.
I never got, on a boat. Yeah, I never got to Manhattan.
But,
I thought it was in a movie called Ashes to Ashes, for Christ's
sake. It was just a weird sequence with her in that room and him, and it wasn't scary. It wasn't him.
Nah.
Well, Julius, has he ever done anything else, Julius? He was good in this.
V.C. Dupree. I think he was in one of the Children of the Corn sequels, like part 3 or 4.
They have black people in Nebraska?
One or two.
Okay. He's good in this. He's really good in this. Julius and a few of the other surviving teens have somehow found a cache of weapons on board.
Well, they were shooting skeet in the beginning.
The shotguns make sense, but there were some pistols they found and some axes, I guess fire axes and whatnot.
Which one are you going to take, Julius?
Just these, his fists. And they
it was all nothing.
No, just these. And he's like, and this. And he pulls out the shotgun. That was a good line. I say that him and a few other surviving teens... Because, like I mentioned earlier, there was 75 kids on this boat to begin
with. Now they're nowhere to be seen.
And they've all disappeared.
Yeah.
So you have to just assume Jason's killed them, I guess.
I guess.
Or they lowered the dinghies Titanic style and rowed the fuck out of there.
I don't know. We're down to
10. Those were the honor students of Crystal Lake High. Fuck
At this point in the movie, I'm like, where's the Manhattan?
The guy did come up and say this thing is doomed. I'm out of here.
Where's the Manhattan part of this film?
Oh, I think everyone's saying that at this point.
Get to that in a minute.
They're down to about 10 people on the boat now. JJ searches down the engine room. Wayne, sorry. In my notes, I have JJ as the nerd videographer. So Wayne grabs a shotgun, and he goes down, and he's using his VHS camcorder spotlight as
that's always smart.
To explore down there. But when a steam valve blows steam in his face, knocking his glasses off...
Hey, we can relate to that, huh?
That's
well,
right,
Scooby-Doo style. It's like Thelma.
I can't see.
All of a sudden, he can't see. But he's looking through his viewfinder of his camcorder, and all of a sudden, a figure approaches him, and he blasts him with a shotgun. But it turns out to be the young Mincy deckhand. Aqua Mincy?
I can live with that.
As we always say, Tut, sometimes the best laid plans of mice and mensy oft go awry.
And he kills the deckhand, and he does a very poor job of showing remorse. Like there's kind of this moment, but before you know it, Jason shows up and tosses Wayne into an electrical control panel and
starting a gigantic electrical
fire. Well, at this point, I'm like, you know what? This ship is completely unsafe because Jason tosses him onto a panel that just bursts into flame. It's not like he hit it. It was an electrical open panel. No. It's a standard control panel because I had to rewind and watch it again. Like, wait a second.
I love when Cody takes a technical approach to things.
There's no way that thing should just spontaneously combust into massive.
He literally just tosses him.
But don't they show like a thing of open gasoline next to it?
No, it is just a standard control. Touch it, boom!
Captain Robertson was so obsessed with getting his son to be able to understand maritime law that he wouldn't make sure the ship was safe.
This could have tied into him not blowing that international maritime signal at the right time.
He is obsessed about the wrong ship maintenance. Paltry.
It blows up. It blows up Wayne, and it starts a huge fire down in the engine room.
Would have been funny if McCullough all of a sudden walked down, saw him on fire, and went, "There's your senior prediction."
I think everyone would have guessed this is how you end.
In flames.
In flames. Just like your filmmaking career. No, that's what my guidance counselor said to me.
Carry on.
No, let me drink some more OPA.
I thought the Poseidon adventure was unsafe.
But the death visually isn't violent at all. We don't see his skin burning. But it was filmed. You did see skin melting. Just none of it made the final cut. McCullough is now back on the bridge reporting. Rennie's safe in her stateroom. No thanks to you.
No thanks to the two of you.
And then he goes on to blast both Miss Van Dusen and Sean for not knowing how to steer this giant ship. What do you mean you don't know how to steer this vessel?
He's like, he's doing his best, Charles. He's a captain's son. He should know how to pilot this vessel.
Okay, that makes no sense. But a fire alarm is sounded as a result of Wayne's burning body. But McCullough says, ignore it. It's clearly a distraction to get us worried.
How do we know there is a fire?
Well, there's just plumes of smoke.
It might be the plumes of smoke.
So, Charles, there's a fire. How do we know there is a fire? Who would start that? But someone would start a panic.
I'll tell you who would start it. That creepy deckhand. He's been behind this all the begin. Then McCullough pulls out this flare gun. And she's like, Charles, no one will see it out here. He's like, one person will see it.
Only one person needs to see it. The same person has been fomenting dissent.
Well, he's going to go kill the deckhand. He's pretty sure he's behind it all. He tried to stab him earlier. He's going to shoot his ass with his flare gun.
You wonder how many of his students McCullough shot a flare gun at while he was giving the guy.
I'm guessing McCullough's like the Mike Leach of Crystal Eye. Exactly. He's locking kids in sheds. Jason is now taking out dudes right and left. He impales one, the guy that tries to climb up into the crow's nest. He climbs up there with him and throws him down on the antenna, knocking out their... They can't SOS anymore. SOS? That's a maritime distressing?
Yes.
Sure. Again, run with it. Don't pause.
And he throws Julius overboard. He just tosses him over the side. Jason punches his arm through Rennie's window. She's locked in her... The uncle locked her in a room. She's safe because he locked her in there. She can't get out. Which I'm thinking that's the case at their... I'm thinking that's the case at their house,
okay,
too.
Okay, and that's my question. So is this porthole in her room... Well, is it on the outside of the ship? Is there a deck out there? Like,
exactly.
Did Jason just, like, I'm crawling along the side of the ship? I mean, at this point, it's literally saying, like, I'm going to be wherever I need to be.
You know, my cousin Mark is a travel agent. We really should have Skyped him in tonight. He knows a lot about ships. He could have told us the different parts of the ships. Like,
but what I'm saying is, I mean, literally, if you open the window, it would be like it's on the side of the ship.
There's before nothing you hit the there. Water.
How the... I'm going to be right here because there's going to be someone.
He punches through and he grabs her.
They should have shown Jason clinging to the side of the ship, smoking like a Winston, going like, God, this is taking fucking forever.
He's choking her, young slimy Jason, the 12-year-old slimy Jason's watching. So it's like, is she imagining young Jason and old Jason? Like, what's real, what's not real?
Well, I've been in, twice as weird. Had old Jason look through the porthole, too, like, oh my God, what am I doing there?
Not only does the dog see him, but old Jason sees him.
Well, she grabs that pen that Stephen King pen or Ms. Van Dusen gave her and stabs Jason right in the eye with it through the window, and she breaks
free. She misses everywhere else on the mask, but except the
eye. So some viscous, slimy goo comes out of his eye.
Yeah, but he's fine. Ms. Van Dusen, speaking of her, Colleen, meaning well, as always, she's a good teacher. She gathers what graduates are left. We see some graduates we haven't seen in a while, like 15 of them, and they're looking to their teacher for guidance. She grabs them all, and she tells them, stay together here in the restaurant area of the ship where they'll be safe. And then moments later, the engine room explodes, and the restaurant kills all those kids. Way to go, Van Dusen.
Well, we need to get rid of them.
As they prepare, she also drops the lifeboat. So as they prepare to board the lifeboat...
What was so funny about this scene, though, is
there's been about 10 of them on the ship.
I've dropped the lifeboat without anybody in it. How'd you get back down into it?
Now we'll just jump into it and break our arms and legs.
I think that's protocol. I think you do lower the lifeboat.
No, you lower the lifeboat with people in it.
And you don't jump 20 feet off the side.
International maritime law. You're lowering the lifeboat as if this were the Mauritania, for crying out loud. Get in the vessel first before you lower it into the international waters.
All right, Captain Stubing. I would assume you'd lower the boat first, and then once it's stable, you climb down a ladder and get
into
it.
You lower the boat with people in it.
Correct.
All right. I'm wrong in this instance. Takes a big man to admit when he's wrong.
A fine bosun's mate you'll make.
Well, she says that she lowered the lifeboat. The creepy deck, as they get to go on it, the creepy deckhand shows up, who warned him about all this. And he comes stumbling. Charles McCullough is about to shoot him with the flare gun.
But the guy's
stumbling with a knife in his hand. He looks just drunk. But then he falls forward. He's got
TNCC style.
But he's got an axe in his back. TNCC style. 3 hours from now.
Well, you give it 3 hours.
They all pile into the lifeboat. All that's left at this point are Rennie, Sean, Miss Van Dusen, and McCullough. The best of the best. And suddenly, as they get in the boat, a figure shoots out of the sea onto the side of the boat. And you think it's Jason.
No.
No, it's Julius.
Yay!
He could swim.
He's been down there shadow boxing octopuses.
He could live down there. But he climbs on board.
Which it was nice to see that in an age where the brother is usually the first one to go in the horror films. No, he gives a good showing.
Hey. Hung in there till the end. I was thinking it was going to be Aquamancy. That deckhand was down there like, I've got my dolphin friends. I'm going to lead you to safety.
He's got the little the telepathic waves coming up his forehead.
I'm Aquamancy.
Why not? They're doing everything else natural in this.
Aquamancy's dead. Somehow he survived the choppy seas, and they bring him on board. There's a quick shot of McCullough looks kind of annoyed that Julius is alive. Like, I guess there's room for one more.
We don't have enough rations to get to Manhattan.
But I also think McCullough, there's a moment of relief on his face because he's not planning on paddling too much on this voyage.
Yeah, finally. Sean, Julius, take the oars.
Well, some time has elapsed when we go back to the lifeboat. And when we rejoin the weary survivors in the lifeboat, as expected, Julia and Sean are doing all the rowing. McCullough's just laid back in the... what's the front of the ship called?
The bow.
The bow. He's laid up in the bow of the ship, just... Is that as fast as you can paddle?
No, Sean's got that mechanical device.
No, he's got this GPS device, and McCullough's got a great line. Any idea where we are, Captain?
It's like, okay, we're in the fog-shrouded Atlantic Ocean, you dumb shit. Why don't you lay on... And like, Julius gives up pep talk. Hey, man, if I made it, so can you. That nice navigation skills, Captain Cook. I guess at this rate, we'll find the Sandwich Islands before tomorrow.
No, everyone, listen to DeSoto. He's just bitching about everything.
Colleen, if you think Vasco da Gama here is going to help us find the shore of Manhattan.
Dude, if you were Julius, you'd throw that guy over
the
side.
Oh, hell yeah, yeah.
If anybody asked, Jason got him.
Exactly.
And I think Colleen, Miss Van Dusen, so you know, like, yeah. Thank you.
Thank
yeah,
you.
Let's screw that.
Exactly.
Keep paddling, Magellan.
Nobody's going to miss this guy.
Keep paddling, Magellan.
But eventually...
I'm just surprised at the amount of explorers you guys rattled off
dude,
there.
With DeSoto, Magellan.
I'm something of a history major.
Mm. Yeah. I don't know if you know this. DeSoto was in search of the Fountain of Youth.
DeSoto?
Yeah.
DeSoto is a town south of Dallas.
He was also a Spanish explorer.
He's explored DeSoto. I'm sure of that.
This Google may it. Not be the Nina Maria, Santa Maria, or the Pinta, but if Columbus here can find Manhattan.
Well, our tired, weary troop do indeed eventually spot the Statue of Liberty.
Well, Cabeza de Vaca has given a safe boy.
They're saved. They see the Statue of Liberty. They're saved.
Finally, New York.
One would imagine they'd all be rejoicing once they arrived safely on shore. But good old McCullough.
By the way, this is like an hour and 30 into
correct.
This movie.
Jason takes Manhattan. They're just now getting to Manhattan.
I point this out exactly because I watched it. The movie is 100 minutes long with end credits. So an hour
80 minutes there?
At the 61st minute is when you see Jason climb out of the water. They're in minute 61 of 100 with end credits. That's when they finally are in New York. And they're not in New York. It's some back alley stage in Vancouver.
Yeah, yeah.
This is a fine place for you to dock a seafaring vessel.
You'd think they would just be so happy they were on shore, but
McCullough,
no, not
we just paddled your ass across the fog trout of Atlantic.
This is a good
place to dock your vessel, Sean.
At that point, you throw him back in.
Exactly. Oh, we just saved your ass from Jason.
Jason did it.
But he doesn't even say it in his loud voice, his sarcastic voice. He dusts his blazer off. This is a fine place to bring us ashore in the vessel, Sean.
Way to go, Admiral Robinson.
Nice move, Sir Francis Drake.
Well, guess who else made it safely to the dock somehow?
Who?
Can you guess? Any guesses?
Aquamancy.
No, Aquamancy.
This is what it sounds like when voice cries.
Jason makes it.
Sorry.
They've been rowing, these two in-shape high school athletes have been rowing for God knows how long. Jason is right there with them.
No, but he's like Kevin Costner's character in Waterworld. He's been underwater so long, he's developed the gills.
He's got the gills.
He probably doesn't cling to the boat like a barnacle.
But here's my thing. They were in a boat, so what is he doing? Is he just walking?
He's just walking along the bottom.
But that's what I wanted to see. Like, him walking across the bottom of the sea, like, punching an octopus.
No, I think he's under the boat like Robert De Niro in Cape Fear holding the back of that car. He's just under there like...
Nah, but dude, I just would love to see a scene of him just marching across the seafloor, like stepping on crabs.
Just a big great white shark jaw style comes at him and he just punches it in the nose.
Punches it. He's clearly just been marching across the seafloor to get there. So he climbs up the same dock they got to. And we're now officially... on land in Manhattan, an hour into the film.
In these seedy, creepy, toxic, waste-filled back alleys.
It's just, how did he get from the Lazarus to Liberty Island? It makes no sense. But
at nothing this, at in this point, movie does.
You know, why would you question it? Cut. I just really want to see him punch an octopus in the face.
This is Kate at the zoo style.
Oh, Mincy, you know Daddy's not allowed in the zoo anymore.
Dad, will you and Uncle Mincy take me to the zoo? Oh, Katie, you know Daddy's not allowed at the zoo anymore. Oh, yeah.
Well, it's basically the train of thought the filmmakers had the whole time. Fuck it, just get
fuck
in there.
Fuck it, yeah.
And you know what? The other Fridays never betrayed that sense of time and space that this one does. There was always a reason how he got to where he was going. Yeah. It could have been bullshit, like, you know what, these guys are running and he fine, but this is just a blatant disregard for...
It is, and the blatant disregard comes from the fact that it's Friday Part 8. They don't want us to question these
guys.
He's
everywhere, and just that's what we're doing here.
And he's got perfect GPS. Where are my victims? They are over there. I'm going to head in that direction.
Well,
I'm going to just punch out this marlin real quick, and I'll get on shore.
Unfortunately, before the survivors can find a payphone to call the cops, two thugs rob them at gunpoint and take their wallets. Not only that, they take Rennie with them on top of it.
Did anybody else have a problem with the fact that Julius
in his sweatsuit, had dived into the water, and he still has his wallet in his pocket.
In his sweatsuit.
In
his
jacket. Like, first of all, when you came out and grabbed your shotgun, you didn't have your wallet. If somehow you did, when you dove into the North Atlantic, he did all of a sudden, give us your wallet. He's like reaching into his soggy pocket, pulls his little Velcro wallet. There you go.
You should at least see him at least wring it out like some of the water. I am so sorry.
Well, they leave with Rennie, and Julius is like, let's do it. We're going to get them. And Charles McCullough is like,
did you hear what they said?
They'll kill her. The best thing to do is to split up. I'm in charge here. All right. So they all go like four different directions. And that's that because McCullough said so. The street hoods take Rennie back to their little alleyway and inject her with cocaine.
There is just a
was
ton
it cocaine
of
or heroin?
The whole city.
Or,
no, it's cocaine. They say it's cocaine.
They inject her with something. It doesn't matter anymore.
And then right before one of them rapes her,
because I thought it was heroin, and I was like, "This is the most ineffective heroin I've
cocaine,
ever seen."
Because he tells the other guy, "Go take some money, get us some more cocaine.
Room for the long night."
And then
because she recovered extremely well.
Yeah. Well, right before one of them rapes her, Jason shows up. He takes the dirty cocaine syringe and
shoves it into his spine.
We kind of see a little bit of digging around there.
Yeah, I mean, you see it protruding from the other side.
I mean, but I'm like, okay, he stabbed a needle into his back.
Through his chest.
But you didn't get to see that. It was like...
Yeah, lost opportunities.
If he just showed the guy and, like, Jason punched through his chest, it would have been far more effective.
It would.
Than, like... I stabbed you with a needle. Like, I'm stabbing you with this needle.
Well, then when the other guy comes back to see what the commotion's about, Jason cracks his head open in the steam pipe. God, there's so much steam in this city. Everywhere you look, there's just steam shooting out of buildings.
It's the darkest night of the dark.
And Rennie runs away. She gets out of there.
Even though she's high on drugs, she can have perfect... I'm going that direction. And I'll be free of Jason.
We join Julius now. He's in a phone. He finds a phone booth. Remember those phone booths?
Phone booth.
Phone booth was this conical thing.
It was this magical booth that had a phone in it.
Time before cell phones, there were phone booths.
And this just really gets me because, once again, it's this trash-strewn alley. There's no people around. I'm like, you just went to Manhattan. You went to New York and there's no people.
Even if they landed, the only
people you've encountered are these two thugs.
Even if they landed in the grimiest part of the docks, New York's a 24-hour city. There would have been 100 dock workers there.
Yeah.
But again,
not a soul in sight.
Let's not ask ourselves these questions.
Well, he calls the cops, and as he just starts talking to him, Jason shows up, smashes the glass of the phone booth, and the chase is on. Julius runs out. He climbs up a fire escape to the top of a large building where all of a sudden, boom, Jason's up there with him. And they proceed to box. From one end of the roof to the other, Julius boxes Jason. Body shots, headshots.
Worth pointing out that the budget didn't allow for it. This scene was initially supposed to take place in Madison Square Garden.
That was one of the New York set pieces they wanted.
So the producer's like, whoa, hold on there, cowboy. We're not getting within 10 miles of Madison Square Garden.
There was also a very lengthy chase scene over the Brooklyn Bridge that was written in the script that never got to be done. A lot of New York stuff that would have been really cool to see.
Yeah,
never.
That would at least give you the feel of New York.
Yeah, never.
That was my one problem with the whole New York scene is that I never felt like I was in New York.
They put all their eggs into that Times Square footage.
Right.
Which we'll get to here in a minute.
And I think they may have used the subway station. No?
That was Vancouver.
Really?
Yeah, they couldn't afford New York.
Very little they shot in New York at all.
Yeah. He's just...
But I will say that this scene is probably
one of the great Friday 13th kill scenes. Yeah. It's a really good scene. It's creative. He's beating the shit out of Jason. Jason's just taking these body shots.
Now, I will say this. Before he takes the body shots, he takes like 15 shots to the head.
With a hockey mask on.
Okay, exactly. All right, I'm a boxer. I'm going to hit the hockey mask.
Well, interesting side note. When they show at the end, he gets exhausted. He can't hit him anymore. Right as they're towards the end of the thing. Those shots of his knuckles,
bloody.
That was real blood.
Really?
He actually beat Kane Hodder. Kane Hodder's like, he wasn't pulling punches. Like,
yeah, Hodder said, I got padding on, hit me.
and he really punched the shit out of his mask, his body. Like those were his.
So
bloody,
that was his bloody.
Those were
hand.
His bloody knuckles.
Oh.
He's proud of that. He's like, we did. They didn't touch that up. Like,
All right, good.
I literally went round and round with Jason.
Good job.
So finally, he's just exhausted. He can't punch him. He's like, give me your best shot.
Take your best shot, motherfucker.
Jason clocks him in the head, knocks his head off.
His clear mannequin head comes off.
Knocks his head off, severs his head. It flies off the top of the building. In the only interesting camera move in this entire movie, the decapitation cam, the camera, they threw a camera on a spindle off the side of the building to where it goes
circles
over and over to give you the point of view of the severed head. It falls into a dumpster and it closes. It's a really fun.
Yeah, I was
it's
actually
the first
that
fun
was actually
kill
my,
scene in the movie.
Right, that was that was the one that I liked.
Yeah, they called the decapitated cam shot, and it was nice. It was the only creative directorial move in this whole thing. It's a pretty cool shot. Well, now McCullough has found a police officer. He actually did something
constructive.
And once they track down Miss Van Dusen and Sean and Rennie, they all pile into the squad car. But as the cop is radioing for help, Jason emerges from a steamy alleyway. So much steam. And he kills the cop.
You can never see Jason because it's so
Julius,
much steam.
And the Julius's head is on the hood of the car.
Yeah, severed head is in the cab of the car. It's like on top of the steering wheel. So Rennie climbs over the seat and begins driving the cruiser. But of course she sees teenage Jason again, the hallucination. She sees him everywhere now. He's like all over the place. So she hits the gas. She's like, I gotta kill him. And of course she runs into a building.
Yeah.
And
trying
to kill him.
That the placement of Julius's severed head, it was one of the things that I felt was kind of lacking. Like I said, I'm not a big fan of the genre, but one of the things that I do like about the genre, at least the early films, is that they would always do like the staged, here's all my victims, here's all my kills.
Like trophies.
Right. And I miss that part of it.
That was fun to see that he actually used the head. He went down to that dumpster, dug out that head.
I can use this.
This is a problem. I need to use this.
Well, it was just that I'm really here to fuck with you. And
is a Jason calling card, and it's the only time he played it.
Right.
Well, she, in an effort to kill imaginary teenage Jason, or 12-year-old Jason, she drives the car, they could have just driven to safety, but no, she drives it into a wall, and they get out of the car, and it explodes, killing Miss Van Dusen.
And what's so funny about this is that, you know, 5 minutes ago, I was trying to, this movie is so forgettable, I was trying to remember how Miss Van Dusen dies.
She blows up in that car.
I totally forgot about it until
that's understandable.
Until we're going through this.
That's understandable.
No, it's sad.
I wouldn't go sad, but
no,
I understand why you didn't remember because
it's sad for this proud franchise to be so.
It is weird that she made it all this way just to blow up
just
in the
to
car
blow up in
because.
The car?
And Rennie doesn't seem upset about it.
No, nobody does.
There's a
nobody, nobody. She's the one teacher that cared about you.
Outside of home,
and you
dude,
just killed her.
Outside of home, dude, remorsing about his dad getting killed. Nobody is.
I disagree. There was no trauma with Sean seeing his dad.
See that
even
was,
he didn't register.
They at least tried to attempt to make him remorseful. There was no remorse about any of these characters getting killed.
I'm not an actor, but I think I can recreate Sean's remorse at his dad dying. Ready, Mincy? You're Admiral Robertson, dead.
Mincy's dead, and Cade looks constipated.
That's it.
And that's it.
That's what impressive
scene. About the cheapening of the franchise, there's a doctor essay waiting to come on how this movie and Halloween 5, that both came out in 89, not only served as not the overall death knell for these franchises, but it was a total change in the way they were going to go, as well as something about the 80s being over with both these movies.
Yeah.
Well, as they watch the car burn...
I look forward to that.
As they watch the patrol car burn with Miss Van Dusen inside, poor Colleen...
She tried.
Rennie watches the car burn, and suddenly she remembers something, and we go into a flashback.
In the burning oil, she sees a little boat all of a sudden.
And I will say that this fade from the burning oil to where something that looks like a boat, and then the dissolve into the boat on Crystal Lake, it actually was very
nice. It was a
nice
little moment.
Technically, it was a nice
but
produced
they're
moment.
Watching Sean and McCullough... are watching her watch the burning car, and they're giving her some space And all of a sudden we cut to a flashback of young Rennie as a young girl, 5 or 6 maybe.
Yeah.
Out in a canoe with Uncle Charles McCullough. He's telling her that she needs to learn to swim already.
He's put on a very thin veneer of makeup to make him look a little bit younger.
Yeah, a little bit of salt, some blush.
He totally did.
But she's been coming to visit him at Crystal Lake for years now, and she's yet to learn how to swim, and this is the summer she needs to do it.
I'll learn next time. Oh, you've said that before.
Sure. You know, if you don't learn how to swim, Jason's down there, and he'll pull you under.
How fucked up must it be to grow up in Crystal Lake?
With McCullough as your guardian.
Exactly. I'd have fucking issues, too.
Well, she doesn't really portray those issues very...
No, not really.
But anyway...
Camp. This year, we're going to learn to swim in Crystal Lake, where Jason
and McCullough's world, the way to teach her to swim is he shoves her over the side of the boat.
Swim, Rennie, or Jason's going to get you.
And she sinks down in, and then all of a sudden, there's little Jason down there, which chronologically makes no sense. There's no way that he would be that age.
So
Jason.
Anybody Cody who just lost decides it. To fall beneath the water. 4 feet beneath the water.
Little Crystal Jason's Lake, there.
He's right there. Like 5 feet over. You look over. There's another boat. There's someone struggling and Jason has them too.
And he's kind of a mongoloid, but not really. He's got some long kind of straggly hair, but he's not really crazy looking. But he's grabbing at her. And McCullough's up on the boat. Come on, ready?
You can do this.
There is a ghost child pulling me down.
Well, the thing about that shot is Jason, his head is decomposed.
But the rest of his body
But the rest
is not
of his body is perfectly like a 12-year-old. It's normal. It makes no sense. That was a weird. Why not do his whole body decomposing?
Budget.
Well, she suddenly snaps.
An effort.
She suddenly snaps out of that flashback and confronts her uncle. You threw me. She didn't remember it until
You're
now.
You're the one that threw me.
You threw me in the water.
I was trying to do what's best for you.
But then he tries to turn it around. I may have thrown you in, but I was the one that pulled you out. I saved you.
You saved me from what you did.
Yeah, you saved me, but you threw me in.
Logistics.
I don't need to hear any of your diametric schemes of how this played out.
Oh, semantics.
I saved you. I pulled you out. You threw me in, you bastard.
It's way too late for apologies. As Rennie and Sean then ditch McCullough and run off their own separate ways, McCullough's left alone, and immediately Jason raises up. And he's chasing McCullough. So Jason, again, obviously unstoppable. He's in hot pursuit of McCullough. Real quick, let's have some final words on the cigar. I know you two are done. I'm almost done. Thoughts?
I really liked it. It ended up getting probably through my own fault a little sloppy there towards the end on the draw. I had to keep relighting it. I really enjoyed the flavor, really liked it, but it kind of...
To me, that's kind of the problem I have with the bigger ring gauges.
Still less than 2 hours.
It was a good cigar. I liked it. It had a lot of flavor. It was very flavorful and a fun cigar to smoke. But at the same time, I mean, it's something that you do have to do a little maintenance with. It's something that you have to work with. I'm not a fan of the bigger ring gauges, but... That said, that was a good smoking cigar. I liked it. When it was working right, it was great. It was good flavor to it. That cedar was still throughout the entire deal.
We're at the 2 hour mark with the cigar now.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, I've got about 2 inches left. Cody is a slower smoker. He's got the last third at least left. You guys are done. You want to guess price point at this point?
All right. I will go $13.50.
Right now on Famous Smoke Shop's website, you can order a 5-pack of these for just over $60, which is about $12 a stick.
All right.
$12 for 2 hours of a not boring...
Yeah, can't really beat the value on that.
No, they do sell singles at MSRP, which is around $15 bucks a stick.
Yeah.
For me, it's all about, if I'm in a lounge, take the podcast out of it.
Yeah.
If I'm at a lounge or if I'm out on the deck of the house for 2 hours, if I can smoke a cigar and get transitions throughout, different flavors throughout... I know in a normal setting I'm not going to have to relight and manhandle this thing as much as I have with the lighter, because it's just the nature of talking so much. I got to. It had the flavors I like. It has the.
Yep.
I know I got a lot more cream than you guys did.
Yeah.
But that's the. I love that the spice came and went. Just.
Yeah, it wasn't just a one trick.
No, it just
kind
of came and went.
Yeah.
It bounced beautifully with the power of the beer. Great pairing beer-wise.
Yeah, that's one thing that I will say is that when you get the pale ales or you get the anything with this that's kind of hoppy, to get a cigar that can actually stand toe-to-toe with a very hoppy, flavorful beer like the OPA is, that, to me, that's a good strength. Of course, that's the strength of the cigar. You had a lot of flavors there. You had a lot of nice little taste to it that actually went well with the beer. The beer didn't muscle it around.
Leather and cedar with that cream, home run for me. And mix in that spice. I would definitely, if I knew I was going to have a big chunk of time for a big fucking cigar, I would go back to it.
It's an interesting point, too, that the cigars that we review, we're talking a lot and we're drinking. This would be, I'd really like to try this particular cigar after like eating a big steak or something, and then just sitting outside and just smoking it by itself,
watching the Cubs.
Yeah, we all know how they're going to end up when all things are said and done.
Why you torture yourself like that?
But. No, they're kicking ass.
Going to win 110 games and losing the playoffs, and you know it. I would think, like, you know, instead of, you know, it worked out very well here tonight, but just to, you know, maybe have a steak, a glass of wine, then just sit outside and smoke that by itself.
I could see that.
I felt that thought was put into the blend for the larger ring gauge to get those transitions, which you can get with this, which you can't get with a Lancero or a smaller. You can really hit the good notes the way you wanted to hit them more specifically.
Yeah.
But you can play around a little bit more with the bigger ring gauge. That's why I love a Churchill. It's kind of a medium ground. It's not the beast that a 60 ring gauge is, but there is room on a well constructed cigar to really explore some different things in a long, you know, decent ring gauge.
And when I compare that to other 60 gauges, the Texas Monte Cristo, the Hoya, the Grand Council, the Uzi, I would put this up there. I mean, it's not a forgettable cigar.
It made a really good match with this beer.
I agree.
This worked out really well.
The beer for me is one of the best we've done in a while. Good job.
I agree.
Absolutely. It really worked with this particular cigar. This was a good pairing.
The OPA is great, and you're saying it's out of San Antonio?
Out of San Antonio.
I'm hoping that when we go to Cats Fest and we go down to that little pub, that I'm hoping that they have it there.
There's a place that we eat right down the street from the La Quinta there. It's a
brick house or brick pub house,
a tap
or
wall,
like
but
that.
They got like 40 beers on tap. I'm hoping they have some more.
I could see this beer being agreeable with a lot of different cigars. It worked well with this one. I could see it going well with a lighter. Even it seemed like it was a good flavor, but I could see it really not. It's not the kind of beer that you see really fighting anything.
It's not
going to
fight anything. No, man, I really like it. I was telling on our break. I was telling Cody. I was like, you know, they're a distillery too. I'm curious what they offer on the...
What their spirits are?
Yeah, on the spirit side. Maybe we'll have to make a trip down to San Antonio and...
Well, it's a good thing we're going in 2 weeks.
I'll be Jason-style. Kick open the door and just...
He's everywhere.
I will be covered in slime.
Covered in slime. Just appear right next to him like, hey, what's going on over here? Oh, God!
Where'd you come from?
If you're going to invade our distillery...
If you're going to show up at Cat's Fest drunk as the last lords of creation, the least you could do is bring a favorable cigar along with you.
Well, there'll be many favorable cigars there, but I like it. I like it a lot. And granted, I cannot remember the last time I smoked a non-Cuban Cohiba, so I really don't have a basis on against their Dominican stuff.
Yeah.
But
I do, and that the strength profile on that is quite favorable.
Excellent pairing.
I think good job, Yax, on the beer.
Excellent.
Thank you.
And everyone go to Famous Smoke Shop. And, I'd pick it up. It's a non-boring cigar, which for this size and the amount of time it gives you, I mean, you'll drop $12 on a movie.
Yeah.
And
this is easily hour and a half, 2 hours.
Of course, I guess it's good from Honduras.
Well, he's preparing for Tuttle on the soapbox.
Look, it's right on the border of Nicaragua.
Actually, I will say I need to try more Honduras cigars because ever since you turned me on to Nicaraguans, I came from a Dominican side. That was my flavor profile for many years.
Texas. Oh, wait.
And then when you got me into the Nicaraguans, I really liked to explore it. I have yet to really fully explore the Honduras side, so I'm kind of... And I know that most of the fillers in that was from Nicaragua, so I know it's more Nicaraguan than anything.
I liked it. I liked it more than the Davidoff Nicaragua, which they did around the same time. Davidoff, for the first time, explored in
which is $18, and it's going to go about an hour at best.
Actually, an $18 for a smaller cigar, like a Toro, yeah, maybe.
At best, you're going to get an hour.
Those have never really impressed me much, which I like Davidoff.
Big time, but go old school if you're going
But I
Davidoff.
Don't like that Nicaraguan Davidoff so much. No. I like this better. So, go to FamousSmokeShot.com, pick up a fiver, or, you know, if you don't trust us, a single. But like I said, that's $15 for a single. That's 2.5 hours you're going to have to enjoy something. It's a bargain.
Absolutely.
Do you know what the same time of Coke will cost you?
Right?
Thanks, FDA.
Hey, pretty soon they're going to take away your sodas, too, so...
I hope.
And when if you visit Tut and I at our abandoned sawmill on the island of St. Edward's Island off the coast of Canada.
Watch out for Jason. He can be there, too.
Speaking of which, let's hammer the nail in this puppet.
Yeah, that dastardly Jason. Dastardly? That's another old gold prospector term.
Oh, God.
That dastardly Jason.
I'm the last registered Democrat. Tax and spend. Yeehaw!
Me and those old-timey words. Well, McCullough runs for his life from Jason and finds him hiding in an old building. McCullough runs up. Jason's behind him.
Jason's behind him.
He runs up, and somehow Jason's already up there.
Up there, and throws him out the window, just kind
of
like...
And McCullough never rode that boat. He should have tons of reserve energy.
But I'm just like, what the fuck? I mean, I can suspend my disbelief from a lot of things.
Absolutely.
But come on, guys. Absolutely. This is fucking lazy.
I agree. But he throws him out the window of the building, and then he immediately is down there in the alleyway with McCullough, where he picks him up by his legs and dunks him into... There just happens to be a big barrel of toxic waste.
With dead rats in it. Well, that rat died of an overdose.
Like, you know, the toxic waste is just reached overkill. But yet I am wrong on this. You are so wrong.
So you thought.
I'll get to that when we get there, but...
A barrel of steaming toxic waste. And then I remembered in the very beginning opening credits, they show you a giant barrel of toxic waste.
It all comes back.
With a rat.
Redemption.
With a giant fucking rat in the toxic waste.
It's funny, I was telling Mincy in the documentary when they interview, what's the actor's name that plays?
Peter Mark Richmond.
They interview him. Now he's in his 80s now.
He's pushing 90.
89.
They interview him about that scene. He's like, it was very interesting, the scene of my demise. He still uses those crazy fancy words. Like, there was a barrel, someone thought it would be a nice accoutrement to put a rat on top.
There were dead vermin in the barrel of toxic sludge that I was dunked into summarily.
If you're going to kill me, at least have a barrel of toxic waste with vermin in
it. Granted, I was still sporting wood from my encounter with Tamara.
I will say this, we haven't mentioned in a long time, and I won't go into it here, but... our script for Angel Dust, at the very end, there is a role for a wealthy, eccentric kind of billionaire military industrialist guy, and I would so get that gig. You gotta play it.
Oh, he'd be still criticizing you even when you cast him? I guess R.G. Armstrong was no longer available, was he, Mr. Kane?
Is he still alive?
I'll do my best with the material presented to me.
Is R.G. Armstrong
still nice out? Acting, Mincy. I guess you didn't matriculate at the actor studio. No, he's dead for a long time.
Okay, that makes sense.
I'm gonna have to get me some scissors.
Well, he dunks this guy down into this.
You see the dead rat carcass.
You see the rat floating around
with the heroin needle in the rat's arm.
He just dunks him. And Kane Hodder in his interview was like, the guy was a champ. He's like, it's not like dunking a guy in water. Like, that was an oily based just gook. And it's like, not only are you dunking, you're underwater, but you're just, when I pulled him out of there, he was still covered in it. And I was like, oh God, that wasn't a stuntman. They actually dunked McCullough in there.
They're going to dunk me in a jar of toxic waste.
I held him underneath for 5 minutes, but he was still alive.
He still wouldn't die. We tried to kill him.
Way to dunk, Jordan. he just kept sassing me. I had to keep dunking him.
Dude, Jordan. Still throwing out basketball references. Nice move, Hakeem. Twin Towers, you're not.
How's he talking underneath 2 gallons of water?
Hold me steady, Dream Shake.
That's on his tombstone. Criticized till the very end. Charles McCullough.
Dominique Wilkins, you're not.
Well, he's dead, finally. The
Spud
one redeeming
Webb,
entertaining...
more like Spud McKenzie.
That's pretty good. Spud McKenzie. We need to get one of him in the corner now. Spud McKenzie?
I thought you were talking about Spud Webb.
Yes. He meant to say Spud Webb.
Okay. Is Spud Webb dead?
It's
no,
far
he's
too
alive.
Early,
so. It's far too early to tell. My God! The asphyxiation he must be experiencing when he's dunked in that jar of toxic waste is unbelievable.
It's toxic waste, but the asphyxiation is what's ruined him.
Unbelievable
well,
asphyxiation.
My question at this point was, all right, we're 1989, 1990. Was New York ever really this bad? Like open canisters of toxic waste?
Probably parts of it.
I just love that
everyone on every corner is doing drugs and shooting people. And
I just love the fact that the 80s loved toxic waste so much.
We all love toxic waste. I got a t-shirt that says I love toxic waste.
You should have that t-shirt. I don't know. It was just such an exaggerated notion of New York City. Especially because now it's just so
wrong.
Just a bunch of white people doing boring shit. And everything's so clean and...
I don't know if that's entirely true.
It is. No. I read stuff.
I read. It's
carry on then, maestro.
It's on the internet. It's true.
Well, in my mind, McCullough was the one redeeming entertainment factor this movie had, and he's gone now.
Yeah, it's time to check out.
Or if you're going to say it McCullough speak, I'm one of the only redeeming factors in this disappointing piece of celluloid. He's going to dunk me into a vat of toxic waste.
Nice celluloid.
I really expected to hear like some reverberations inside that barrel. Like him like just critiquing. If you're going to shove me down, you need to push my face all the way to the bottom of the barrel.
I've suffered worse from my last keg stand at Cornell University. Way to go, Voorhees, if that's your real name. If that's your real moniker.
Way to go,
Voorhees.
You know,
there's that scene. There's that
my
little
last
scene
prostate
where you,
exam
where you
was more.
And Jason is really like, you son of a bitch, I'm going to get you in that barrel. I hate you.
Did you guys notice when he was dunking him in there, his... McCullough's trousers, the legs slink down, and he's wearing like tube socks with like stripes on him. Like,
anyone else notice when he leaves McCullough laying there, he's ripe for anyone to come over and violate his corpse?
No.
What?
Actually, I
you were saying?
Tell you want to give the links for the show, or I think we're out of here.
Oh, God.
It is time to wrap this up.
Yeah. Well, somewhere else in the city that never sleeps.
No, we still have more to go.
Oh, God.
This is the city that never sleeps, although there's no other signs of life anywhere in the city.
I mean, I wonder, I was like, this is New York City, right? I mean, this is at least...
There's going to be some of
1989? There's got to be, what, 9 million people?
None. There's no other
there's
people
nobody.
In the city.
Nobody in this city.
Well, Sean decides that now Rennie is all drugged up and in emotional shambles over her fucked up childhood flashback.
It's go time.
It's time to kiss her.
It's time to pull those jeans down.
But the kiss is short-lived as Jason bursts through some boxes.
I wanted to get to her, but I couldn't get those pants off her hips. There's 50 yards of fabric.
The vest. My God, the vest!
That was a hell of a vest.
I needed to spit my beer out.
Rennie, we can use the left leg of your pants to signal for help.
I don't know why she was so troubled by that rapist. There's no way he was getting into those jeans. Oh my God, what is...
That's in the director's cut. He's like, God damn it. He's like trying to pull it off of her.
It was like a denim corset built into the top of those jeans.
I don't know where these things end, and she begins.
McCullough picked those out for her, JCPenney.
Wear these, Rennie.
If I'm going to shop at Miller's Outpost for your denim wares...
Renny, it's time to get your senior trip outfit. Wiener's Department Store.
I've talked the seamstress into sewing 5 pairs of jeans into 1 pair of jeans.
For God's sake, don't shop at Chess King. That's where Wayne got a shirt. I saw Kate and Mincy in there earlier buying their freshman collegiate outfits.
Hey, that's a story for another show. Well, we did at Chess King in the late 90s.
Continue. We had an episode of Chess King.
The final chase is on.
The final?
Finally, Sean and Rennie, they run around the corner of this alleyway, and whammo, all of a sudden, they're in civilization. They're back in the land of the living.
It's the darkest side of the night.
People are milling around everywhere. Sean and Rennie, they zip down some escalators, and you know it's New York City because there's some graffiti on the walls.
Filthy graffiti. Oh, yeah, it's got to be New York.
And they get on the subway. Of course, Jason also catches the subway, and there's a pretty good foot pursuit through the subways as it's rolling. And there's just a crowd of bored, apathetic New Yorkers that don't look up at, like, Rennie and them running.
Well, see,
they don't look
at
up
this,
at Jason.
But at this,
a sun-covered man walking down the middle of him.
But I actually believe that this is one of the scenes that's kind of like New York. Hey, we've seen everything.
At this point is when...
Well, yeah, but, I mean, it's one thing. He comes through and he shoves a few people out of the way, but it would have been different had, like, he walked by and, like, just grabbed that woman... Twisted her head around, 180.
At this point, I am like, my God.
Punched a hole through someone's chest.
We have 15 minutes left in the movie. If they had only filmed, instead of 15%, 35 or 50% of the movie in New York, this shit looks interesting and good. Jason,
yeah,
This is what sold the movie. I love seeing him on the subway.
I mean, you know, they're on the subway. I was just like, I would have been so much interested if he just shoved someone's head.
Like, outside the train, just...
And it, like, you see their head, like, just get chopped off.
And I would still love it if nobody else cared on the subway.
Yeah, exactly. Man,
seeing this every day. It's so ripe for potential, and they never got there.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're going through the subway. Eventually, he corners them, and Sean pulls the emergency brake, which...
I just wanted... You wanted that snarky New Yorker, like, reading the newspaper, tourists.
Something. Jason, like...
Oh! Son of a bitch!
Oh, great, I'm blind now. But I don't care. I'm a New Yorker.
Fuck you.
He pulls the emergency brake, and everyone does that Star Trek thing where they grab on and, like, fake.
Oh, God!
They jump out onto the tracks through the exit door. Jason follows them. Sean does a huge, like, a flying...
elbow. Macho man elbow.
Macho man. Knocks Jason down into the tracks where...
The third rail.
He's
electrocuted. From the third rail.
Which, as we know by now, when you electrocute Jason, he only gets more powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which I was like,
okay,
you can't let him touch electricity.
Okay, so correct me
you
if I'm...
Like McCullough, right?
Correct.
I'm sorry.
You're going to electrocute Jason. Don't use Ben Franklin's kite with a key tied towards it.
So if I'm wrong here, okay, so Jason hits the third rail... electrocutes and, like, goes unconscious or whatever.
For a second, yeah.
And then there's a scene where the camera cuts back to Sean, I guess is the deal, who's got his hand clearly on the third rail.
And he tackles him, and they both land on it.
When he gets up, he's, like, holding on to the third rail for support, and I'm like, oh, wait, that same rail is the one that...
It used up all the electricity on Jason.
Oh, okay.
Once it electrocutes somebody, it's a dead... Yeah.
Oh, it's
circuit.
Dead. Then?
The circuit is dead.
All right,
that's science.
Come on,
Yax.
Now, see, you said that you were so sure of yourself, and then you finally turned to Cody. You were like, "I better get confirmation." If you stuck with it,
if I'd been like, "Once a circuit electrocutes somebody, it's a dead circuit."
We were like, "Oh, okay." If
no, I would still call bullshit on that.
No, see, I knew he was not going to give me that. Thank you, though, Mincy, for believing me.
I always do, brother. I always do. Be firm in your conviction. If you were only firm in your convictions.
Doctor, what kind of electricity would it take to knock out a man the size of Jason?
I would say, Cade, that the voltage going through Jason's slimy corpse at that point must have just been unimaginable.
I can't imagine it.
My God.
My God.
It must have sent untold volts into his genitals.
How many volts?
Well, Mr. Cade, this is a very good question, but... I think it's far too early to tell.
If he doesn't know, Nobody knows.
Nobody knows.
That's true. That's true.
Well, Rennie and Sean then emerge from the subway tunnel up into Times Square. The actual only actual scene I think filmed in New York City, or close to it.
And they are just amazed that people are around.
Yeah.
They're staring.
Well,
like,
no, here's the thing. Despite the madness of what they've just endured over the last 48 hours, last 10 minutes, electrocuting Jason down there, they have a tourist moment.
Yeah.
Oh, this is awesome.
It's Applebee's.
It's New York. Dun, 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 dun.
That's their thing? Oh, it's Applebee's.
You want to go for some half-price apps?
Well,
stop. Rennie, you want to get a Bruce beer real quick?
We still got to find Toby the dog, but then we'll go get some apps. But their touristy moment is cut short because they look behind him and guess who's back?
Jason.
Wait for it. No, you ruined it.
Oh, sorry.
Jason.
And once again, everybody in New York is not paying attention to a...
And there's no...
What I liked about this, though, Jason, when he comes up there, he has a moment where he kind of looks around. But that makes sense. He's only seen trees and lakes and log cabins.
But you know what? He is now surrounded by 10,000 people in his... psychotic urge to kill.
I can kill a lot of people.
And you know what he does? Nothing.
No.
The closest person, he should have just, like I said, he sees someone like, kill. No, he doesn't do anything. He's like, well, you know what? Now I'm going to look around for the people that I was trying to kill. There they are. Hey guys, they're over there. They're across the street. I'm going to kill them.
You know what we left out, and I hesitate to bring this up because we need to wrap it up.
I may have left it out for a reason.
When Jason finally climbs ashore to that dock, he sees the Eastern Hockey League sign.
I did leave that out. And they were so proud of that. They're like, we want Jason's first moment away from Crystal Lake to see his image on a billboard. And there is a little double take where he sees the hockey map. But
and then where he looks back into the camera and it's got him in the foreground, the deal.
We skipped over for a reason. Carry on.
They were very proud of it, but I didn't get anything out of it.
Yeah.
Was he going to raise his slimy fist up?
No. So he starts marching towards downtown square, towards Rennie and Sean. And all of a sudden, he kicks these street punks are hanging out, listening to their boombox. It's rap music, but they're like Mohawk punk rockers.
Yeah.
But one of them's like a Beastie Boy. One of them's like a neo-Nazi. They make no sense.
The guy pulls out a switchblade and he says, "You are accident. Well, you did, slime bag."
Well, he kicks their boombox, destroying their music. So they immediately pull out their weapons, like a... switchblade, some like bicycle
chains, butterfly
chains,
knife, the
nunchucks.
Quintessential knife of the 80s, the butterfly knife.
And they're like, "You're dead, motherfucker." And he turns. It is a great scene.
It is my favorite scene of the entire movie.
He turns towards them, lumbering Jason, raises up his hockey mask.
Which you don't see.
You don't see. It's behind his, it's over his shoulder. He raises up his mask, shows them whatever the fuck's going on under there. And those kids play it good. They look at that face and they're like,
It's cool, man.
They drop their knives and run like hell.
And that was my favorite scene in the entire movie.
I loved it.
I thought that was the one redeeming thing of it.
Yeah.
I really just wanted him to reach over, which obviously at this point is not going to happen because there's no gore in this film, but just to grab like one of their skulls like a bowling ball and just like toss them away.
Oh, dude, rip off the head like a bowling ball, then bowl it and knock them all over like they...
And it makes noise like bowling pins and they all fall down.
Like pins.
Okay, so three of us on the podcast are very dark.
That would have been great.
But you know what? I mean, I'm like, here is a maniacal demon killer...
He does kind of become selective now that he's out.
You want him to grab like people just walking down the street, smack their heads together like boom.
Well, we're about to see some action.
Should have done a dance number. He jumps up on a light post, New York, New York, it's a beautiful town.
Well, Rennie and
the way this movie was going, I thought that was going to happen.
Rennie and Sean find refuge in a diner nearby. And when they alert the apathetic waitress that they're being hunted by a psychotic killer, she gives them the "Welcome to New York."
Welcome to New York.
That was Rob Hedden, the director's sister.
Oh, okay. She did her best, like my cousin Vinny, kind of.
Hey,
welcome to New York, sweetheart. Okay. I think that movie actually came out after this one. But do you think Marissa Tomei based?
No, I don't.
I don't know. Hey, she won an award for that.
God, if only they could have done the whole movie in New York. It could have been so crazy good, damn it. Hey, how was that dirty rat you smoked?
It was great.
Was it good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Come on, quick. Now.
Jason takes on Patrick Ewing in the New York Knicks.
I'm not fucking around with it.
It's good.
Yeah.
What are you smoking up next?
Well, sir, I have gone on to an Ashton VSG.
You like those?
I do. Actually, that and the one you guys did, the Monte Cristo one.
The one that the Cody, one, Cody, Cody found
Cody,
butter.
Cody found the butter.
Or Cody did Cody not didn't find, find the butter. I am smoking.
I swear to God, if y'all keep bringing up this butter, I am going to kill all of you like Jason Voorhees.
Actually, smoking, he didn't kill anybody.
He didn't kill anybody.
I'm smoking the Fink's Commerce Reserva Privada that Tuttle gave me. So far, it's nice.
All right. I'm really curious
for
about
expensive
that.
Cigars that are, well, you know, in that $13, $14 range, ones that we have not had on the show, but that did me well, the Ashton VSG Symmetry that I picked up at TJ's, the big one, was $13. And hats off to Mr. Tuttle. For the big old Opus X, as okay. far as ones we haven't reviewed on the show that you really don't need to because everybody knows what they are. Those are some good
somebody
ones.
Somebody gives us some Opus, we'll,
we'll definitely review we'll do
it. But, the doctor may be bringing some presents for his fellow miscreants to Gatsville.
Okay.
Is that part of the free cigars that you're going to give out for Cade saying, hey...
If someone comes up to you and says, hey, you're the doctor, you're going to give him an Opus?
No, I'm giving free cigars to you guys.
I will provide the doctor cigars.
They're going to get tight in Phillies.
hey, don't knock it until you tried it.
It's too soon on the Finks for me to comment. I'll save that for later.
Let's put this to rest.
Apparently, like I said earlier, there was an ambitious chase scene across the Brooklyn Bridge that they just couldn't do because of budget. Much like the Madison Square Garden boxing scene.
Yeah.
And just, there's so much potential in this premise that they just
lost potential.
So Jason kicks in the door of the diner and stomps his way towards our teenage lovebirds when the gigantic short order cook who works at the diner comes out.
He's a big man.
And not only is he marching out, but there's like a customer there and he like slams his head into the thing to get to Jason. And he's like, he's going to take care of this thing. Interesting trivia note.
Yep, I know you knew
I
it
know
was.
You know this. The stuntman who played the short order cook, a guy named Ken Kurzinger.
Ken Kurzinger.
A friend of Kane Hodder's, a fellow stuntman, he would actually play Jason in Jason versus Freddy.
Okay.
14 years later.
14 years later. So Jason versus Jason in this scene. Friends with Kane Hodder. Kane Hodder wanted more than anything to be in Jason versus Freddy.
Yeah.
But they wanted to go in a different direction with a much bigger, taller...
Yeah.
Physical...
Mistake!
But that guy, the short order cook, is Jason and Jason versus
so
Freddy.
So we're seeing Jason versus we're Jason. Jason.
Well, it doesn't last long. Jason picks him and throws him into a mirror behind the bar there in the restaurant and shatters to pieces.
When Cade and I met Kane Hodder at Frightmare, and it was a year after they did the remake where they used the Derek Mears, who's yeah. another 6'6" guy, and really cool, really friendly guy. We met Derek, really nice guy. I think we had a couple drinks. We had a couple drinks with everybody at that thing. But when we met Kane, we talked.
No, Derek Mears got us in headlocks too.
Yeah, he did too. A friendlier, lighter.
That wasn't like. For a picture op, we actually pissed him off.
We were. I think I urinated on his shoe, and he grabbed his headlock. Now Derek was really cool. We talked to Kane, and we told him, Kane, you actually said to him, "Hey, like, man, you know Derek's cool, but you're the one and only Jason." And Kane was like, "Yeah, he is cool, but he knows that."
These guys are really possessive of their place in horror history. I love the.
I'll say this though: there's one thing earlier you were talking about how meeting. The big time cigar people that run their companies, how different it is from meeting horror. There's a caveat there with some of these actors, like the Kane Hodders.
When I say that the cigar world has been so good to us compared to the film world, I'm speaking of talent behind the camera, producers, fellow directors,
CEOs,
just the people behind the camera. It's a very competitive, unfriendly. The film world, talent. These guys that are in these movies are the most fan-friendly, you can't say enough about them. It's very a good analogy to the cigar world.
And that's
where,
why you see them at the Frightmares, and that's why you see them at the festivals.
And we didn't pay Kane Hodder anything.
Kane couldn't have been.
We went up to him at the VIP party with drunk off our asses and like, hey,
he was drinking too though.
But like,
he had like a beer in each.
Want to get us in some headlocks? He's like, of course. These guys are just really...
And I love that. I absolutely love that.
The only thing I miss about the film world is on-screen talent. Actors. There's very little... even you think
I'm with, right here.
You think with actors, you would get the most ego and the most... Because that's, you know, ego drives you to be an actor. Ego, you want to be seen. You want to...
Not the horror movie crowd.
Watch me play. Watch me be this. But it's in such a welcoming, inviting way, and it's just so nice.
Yeah,
it's funny. The ones that you don't care about are the ones that think their shit doesn't stink. It's a good point.
Yeah, like Kate and I are looking at it. We're like, wow, it's Kane Hodder. He's this big, larger-than-life dude, but he just comes over and we're like, hey, Kane. And he's like, yeah, sure, I'll choke you and your wife. That's fine. I'll put Mincy in headlock.
And usually I have to write a big check for that. but no, it's weird, and it's cool to meet these people. You know,
it really is.
They just had Frightmare again this last weekend, actually, and I don't know if I'll ever go again. I kind of got the experience, but I do miss it, seeing pictures of things. And
we had an awesome experience because we chose that one because of Carpenter and George Romero, and we met a lot of other great people there, too.
Yeah.
I mean, those are the headliners, and we were happy to meet them. But we didn't spend a lot of time with John Carpenter. You actually did. You went and had a smoke with him and talked to him a little bit. We didn't spend a lot of time with Romero. We met a lot of great people. I think, buddy, we will probably go to one of those again. It's just really picking the moment.
I think so.
I think the one that
when Tom Atkins comes to Frightmare, we'll be there.
And he's pushing 80, or might be 80.
Yeah,
so,
we'll be there.
Yeah.
Still got the mustache. We'll be there.
Dude, let's do this.
What I loved about the diner scene, as Jason demolishes that guy and starts marching towards Rennie, they escape out the back. The diner patrons, they're just so annoyed that their meal is... They're not scared of Jason. They're just still eating their eggs. And like, eventually they get up and kind of just slowly shuffle out, like, we just don't want to be bothered. Or like when the police come, we don't want to give a statement. They're not scared at all. They see this every day. Again,
we're
New
Yorkers.
New York ever this bad?
Apparently so.
I don't think so. I don't remember that episode of Seinfeld where a killer burst into the diner, Monk's Diner, and killed people, and George and Elaine were like, eh.
There's something to it, though, and not to get off on a different tangent, but I was reading, I love IMDb, every time that we do a film, I always go and scour all the trivia and everything, and to get into a totally different genre, a totally different movie. But it kind of goes with the people in the big city turning their heads a different direction. Bradley Cooper, before he was a star, was talking about when they were shooting the first Hangover movie. And he talked about how it's toward the end of the movie, and they're walking down the streets of Vegas in broad daylight. And he said he's got all this, it's all makeup, but he's got all these bloody cuts and everything on his face and blood on his shirt and this like IV bag attached to him for the scene. And he's like, I'm walking down the street of Vegas in broad daylight, and nobody wanted to look at him. He was like, I look like I've just gotten the shit beat out of me. No one knows who he is at that point. And he was like, everyone was just kind of like, nah, I don't want anything to do this. Just kind of kept their head lowered and just walked right past him. So there is kind of an element to that with New York. I mean, if a guy in a hockey mask walks in and starts throwing people around, maybe it's a little bit different, but there is that sort of, that's part of the New York mythos, I guess, if you will. And
We've seen everything.
Kind of what they want to do with Jason Takes Manhattan, that this is New York. If Jason showed up, they are going to turn their heads.
Well, they certainly, that was the direction. Act like this, you've seen this shit every day. And it was a choice, and I liked it. I appreciated it. Well, they run out the back, and luckily for Renee and Sean, there's an open manhole right behind the restaurant where they just can zip.
So obviously you need to go down
there.
They
can just zip down into the sewer system.
Wise decision.
If you're going to escape, don't climb into the New York City sewer system.
Well, they do, and Jason is, of course, in hot pursuit. They immediately bump into a sewer department worker down there who informs them that the sewer is flooded every night with toxic waste.
He's covered in shit-covered rubber slickers.
Has that ever been something that ever has existed in any type of...
I don't know, but it's fun to amaze me. Where's it flushing from? Where's it... How's it... And how's it not destroying the...
He says it's
toxic,
so bad.
Toxic waste melts everything.
He says it's so matter of factly too. Like, well, it's about to be midnight. Ten minutes from now, they flood this with toxic sludge every time at this hour. We gotta get out of here.
Let's mosey our way out of here.
I'm not gonna hurry though.
I'm not gonna. They don't.
I'm
need
already
me to
covered in the shit.
They don't need me to radio in to say I'm out of here. They'll just do it. And let's just get out of here.
It's the craziest thing. Like, that's never been a thing.
No.
But the fact that he just
I think
said,
I looked at Cody like.
That's never been a thing.
Yes.
I know it's never been a thing, but I want you to say it.
Yes, it has.
This is what it sounds like.
Apparently,
sludge cries.
To this movie, they flush toxic waste every day.
It's so freaking matter of fact. They flush the sewers with toxic waste.
You don't
waste
have that moment with Sean like, what?
What?
Fuck are you doing down here? This is your job? Jesus Christ.
Well, first of all, it's like the sewage worker has a good line like, what are you kids doing down here? And he's like, get me out of here.
No, then they're like, okay, fuck are you doing down here?
Well, if they don't get out pronto, they're goners.
I don't believe in anything anymore. I'm going to law school.
But before they can find a way out, Jason kills that worker, and then he knocks out Sean.
Who's grateful to be dead.
Yeah, you had that job?
He's like, kill me.
But before he can kill Sean, Rennie finally yells out, you didn't get me in the lake when I was a kid. You're not going to get me now. And she runs away, luring him away from saving Sean. She's the hero.
The
Sean.
Strong feminine character in the 80s that they said that we never had.
She questioned Jason. She's like, you didn't get me then. And that upsets Jason. Nobody likes their performance question.
He's like, it's your jeans. I can't get through those jeans.
He's angry and he goes after her. Nobody likes their performance question. That style. So he starts chasing Rennie, and he takes off after. Rennie, as she's running, finds just a random bucket of toxic waste hanging out down there, like a, and tosses it in Jason's face. Immediately melts it, starts melting him off. He grabs the mask, he tears it off. And we're introduced to Muppet Jason.
Toxic Avenger Jason. Toxic Avenger Jason.
No, it's Muppet Jason.
And this is
he
where
looks
I'm
like a
fucking
Muppet.
And this is where I'm like, this is fucking stupid. I hate the fact that you see
it's not,
Jason.
It's, well, first of all, it's not scary at all.
Well, yeah. you've actually seen this in the previous version of Part 7, the New Blood.
But when that...
He looks like Lizard Boy.
When that mask rips off, he's scary looking.
Yeah, he's Lizard Boy.
This, he looks like a fucking Muppet.
I didn't see that. I think you shouldn't
Would
show.
Would it have been funny if the other Muppets has come out?
What
Like
what
Dr. Beaker? Like,
I mean, what happens...
Put your mask back on.
What happens with Michael Myers when you see Michael Myers?
You don't.
Exactly.
Exactly.
There's something there to keep it. And if you are going to find this is the last Jason, you're going to kill him, and it's all no holds barred. You can show it. Don't make it look like a Muppet.
Waka waka waka. Who wants to hear a funny ass joke?
It's like, this is who's been chasing them? This guy looks ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's not scary. It's not terrifying.
It was horrible.
It's comical.
It was horrible.
It is not.
Well, Rennie circles back around to get Sean. And they sprint through the sewer looking for an open manhole to climb up. They got to get out of here. Where are the Ninja Turtles when you need them? Don't they live down there?
Yes, they do.
It'd be funny if they tripped over some pizza boxes.
What was his name? Splinter? He was that OD'd rat in the toxic waste jar.
Well, he was there.
Now we know where Splinter came from.
Well, Muppet Face Jason is stumbling behind them. He's like smashing. He's fucked up. He's hurting. Just as they finally get to a ladder and start to climb to safety, Jason grabs Rennie's legs and starts to pull her down. But he's a few seconds too late because it's time for the toxic waste flood. This huge wave of toxic waste floods down there. Oh, God. It melts Jason. Even though the toxic waste splashes on Rennie's jeans...
Nah.
It doesn't... Well, those jeans.
Man, those jeans. Nothing gets through
Jordache.
That was like climbing into a refrigerator to avoid a nuclear bomb. You get those jeans, you're just like...
Well, I kept wondering because it was splashing up on her because she was kind of high, but it was still... I'm like, man, it's not burning her feet off. Oh, those jeans. Just jeans and keds. They survive anything. But dude, Jason gets the blunt of it. It starts to immediately...
Right, you would expect like molten hot magma like... And just like turn, like just completely just...
But there's
the energy sucked out of it.
Yeah, but there's plastic piping down in there that isn't melted at all.
The lights that are totally fine.
But it melts Jason, completely just starts disintegrating him. He comes up in the water, his face is melting off. As the toxic wake then begins to recede, we see that he's been transformed once again to a scared little 12-year-old boy.
Which makes no sense.
He's kind of lying on the floor of the sewer then in his little 12-year-old boy in his underpants, which... This is the second show in a row where we've mentioned a 12-year-old boy in his underpants.
Well, you figure them jumped out.
Let's end that trend now.
Get that 12-year-old boy in his underpants. Let's kick him.
It was meant to be a bookend to the series. If the director was like, if I was given permission to kill Jason, I want to bring it back to where it all started. The young boy drowning in this. There was actually a shot filmed, which you can find online. I watched it in the documentary. Originally, they had a huge prosthetic thing done of Jason, the Muppet Jason head, the teeth of that mask, and the young Jason crawling out of the mouth, like he was coming out of Jason.
Then Kermit the Frog shows up.
But they're like, it just looks...
Jeez, I'm sorry, Miss Piggy.
They're like, it looks so horrible.
That was my Kermit the Frog voice.
It looks so bad we couldn't...
You're abused.
We couldn't use it. It looked so bad. Dude, it was a big Muppet mouth with this little kid crawling out of it.
But even that makes no sense.
And then at one point, the director actually has the balls to say he was trying to do a 2001 Star Child thing. Like,
no.
The infant.
I am done.
I'm done.
Seriously,
I'm out.
Let's wrap it up. And when he goes to the star baby, I had a Kubrick moment in mind. Directing Jason Nick's Manhattan, you stupid son of a bitch. Don't come at me with some fucking Kubrick.
Nothing Kubrickian about this.
You had no Kubrickian elements here. I thought I would.
If you're going to bring in Kubrickian elements,
he was so earnest when he said,
"If you're going to recreate a Clockwork Orange, for God's sake, bring in Malcolm McDowell, not Scott Reeves."
But Rennie and Sean are up on this ladder and they're looking down at the 12-year-old boy, and he's alive. The 12-year-old boy is down there, kind of crying.
Yeah.
So what do they do?
Kick him.
Get the fuck out of here.
Get out of there. They never mentioned that boy again. Like, should we rescue him? Should we... It's a little kid.
I just wanted them to, like, crawl up, and all of a sudden there's a guy with the bazooka that they can fire back into the hole.
I encourage you to go to YouTube and find that deleted scene of the Jason mouth with the boy crawling out of it. It's so bad looking. Here's a piece of trivia for you. The boy who played young Jason in the movie was the editor's son.
Of course.
And no, but he said it was so weird editing the film, like when it's my kid, like covered in all this crap.
That
and
son
like,
recently ran for president under the name Ted Cruz. Oh no! Too soon! Oh,
way too soon.
We are not political here at the Tuesday Night Cigar Club.
No, we're not. But I could see where he was going, trying to bookend, bring it to a full circle with lake drowning, toxic waste drowning, but God, it just falls on deaf ears at this point.
Blind eyes.
So Rennie and Sean,
blind eyes.
We're done.
As perplexed as they are at all this, they just shoot upstairs and start sightseeing again. Oh, we're back in Times Square, looking around.
It's the darker side of the night.
It's a Chipotle. Did you guys notice when they were in Times Square on the neon sign, the one at the top was Suntory Whiskey?
Yes, I saw Suntory Whiskey, yes.
When it's time to kill new
teens.
When
it's time to watch Jason Takes Manhattan, it's Suntory time.
All of a sudden, you see the POV of a figure coming out again from around the corner towards them. You're like, oh God, he's back. What's now? It's Toby the dog. He somehow found them, her missing dog.
Oh, jeez.
Mr. Pickles.
So then, Sean...
I think you'd know that.
For all his troubles in this, she gives Sean a innocent little peck on the cheek.
I guess.
Minimal score there, I guess.
He's like, come on, Rennie.
The dog runs up to him, and then that terrible rock song.
It's the darkest side of the night.
Starts back up again, and boom, we're end credits.
Thank God.
You asked why I would do this movie out of all the Friday 13ths.
Yeah.
It is by far not my favorite of the series. It's actually very low on the list. I wanted to get a Friday 13th in there for next week for Friday 13th. With this series, because I would like to visit some of the better entries down the road, I want to start at the end.
Yeah.
Let's see how it's done horribly, because I think we'll maybe appreciate how much better it's done working backwards.
Yeah.
And
let's give a shout out though to Peter Mark Richmond's McCullough.
To McCullough.
He brings entertainment factor to this.
If you're going to toast to me,
the least you could do is drink from the boot of remembrance. You're all charlatans and knaves.
I wanted to...
Because this movie was horrible.
I thought we could have fun with it, but I also thought by telling you everything that's wrong with one of these...
Well, I think we had fun with it, all right.
Next time we'll go back to one that works really well, and we'll appreciate it more because... It's not this one. Does that make sense?
It does. Absolutely.
All right. Well, Jason Takes Manhattan made a new record low for the series, 14 million, which was far below the 20 million of the previous
Did not
entry.
End the series, but ended it with Paramount.
If you only spent $5 million on it and they made $14 million off of a stinker.
They made some scratch, and this was during the home video boom where they made a fortune on clubs like me and Mincy who bought the tapes. It led to a three-year drought where Jason was missing in action on the big screen.
Four, actually. I think 93.
Well, until Paramount gave up the rights to original creator Sean S. Cunningham and New Line Cinema, where he decided to take it in a total opposite direction and send Jason to hell.
Yeah.
Which, that was... You thought this movie was... That,
bad.
That was a whole nother...
Jason Goes to Hell's got some moments, but I think...
Like this one. Actually, much more moments I would give it than this one. But at least they tried something new there. But this was basically the end of Jason as we knew him for the first eight movies.
Yeah. The first eight movies.
I want to real quick give a shout-out to Sirius Canada... it's a Sirius radio station. A fellow podcast legend, Stuart Feedback Andrews, the host of Rue Morgue Radio, which was my first podcast I ever discovered. The best fucking podcast I've ever heard in my life, Rue Morgue Radio. He was a guest. It's defunct now, but he was a guest on Sirius Canada Radio. They did a Friday retrospective, and they did a giveaway for the Blu-ray of Camp Crystal Lake Memories, the Blu-ray documentary on the making the films, and I won it. So they sent me the documentary, and it is, if you have any interest in these films, it is the most entertaining, informative. It's a fantastic... I've only gotten through the second Blu-ray. I mean, it's like 3 hours long, but so much of what we talked about tonight I gained from watching.
Yeah.
It was directed by Daniel Farrens, who started out. He's the writer of Halloween.
Producer's cut. Yeah, okay.
He's also done this with Nightmare on Elm Street. He did They Never Sleep Again. He's very big on really documenting these old series really well. And go out and seek that out. And thanks to Stuart and them for giving me the Blu-ray, because it did help a lot, kind of wrap my head around. It's just so cool to see. It's narrated by Corey Feldman. He does the narration, and I love seeing these stories told by the people involved, and director and Kane Hodder and all that. But then you see these actors that they haven't really done shit since, and they're so happy to talk about this experience in their lives.
Well, it's kind of one of those things where I've always said that with horror movies, there's no middle ground. Either you're a diehard fan that's going to go to a convention like you and me, Cade, or you just don't like them at all. I don't really think there's a middle ground for it. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think by and large you're at polar opposites of it.
Well, I don't know because I'm not that big of a fan of the genre per se, but I'm a fan of the industry, I guess, the craft. And from what you guys tell me about, you know, how accessible these actors are and how nice they are, I would love to actually
That's something that definitely then... If we can't all get together, then you should come up to Dallas and go to a Frightmare with me next year.
because it is fun.
It's a blast. That's why I started there. I feel we'll work our way backwards. Once a year, there's going to be a Friday the 13th. Maybe we can just drop in. And
sometimes twice a year.
I'll pick a better one next time, I promise. I know this is a moot point with Tut because he doesn't like these films, but do you guys have a favorite Friday the 13th film?
I'll let Cody go first because I obviously could write a thesis paper on the series.
Looking back, I mean, probably the first one just because, I mean, it's the original.
Yeah.
See, the first two mean nothing to me because...
Same here.
I picked it up once Jason was at... The first two, Jason's not in those movies.
Friday and 13th.
Well, he's in part two.
He's in part two with the sack
on his head. He wears the bag.
But I really was introduced with part three. My Uncle Dave...
3D.
Up in Ohio. We used to watch The Big Chuck and Little John Friday night as a local show out of Cleveland. And they play horror movies on Friday night. And when I'd go stay the night with him, he'd show them to me. And they played Friday 13th Part 3, which is where Jason gets his mask.
In 3D.
And it's amazing how cheesy that original 3D is.
Cheesy awesome.
I was about to say, that's actually my favorite one.
Yeah, that's right.
Of course, I've only seen, like, well, with this one, three of them.
That's right up there with Jaws 3 for 3D, far as the cheesy factor.
For me...
I like the Jaws 3
3D. Me too.
For me...
That's a podcast. That's a future podcast.
For me, the first two don't have the same weight because I haven't seen them as much. But for me, part three is up there. But six is the epitome for me.
Go back and see two again.
Of entertainment.
I think two came out in 81. And I think in 2011, I think Horror Hound did a retrospective on 81. And I was, like you, unfamiliar with two. I went back and watched again, and it's not bad.
I love part four, too.
Did finish your thoughts.
I would go six just from entertainment factor. They introduced just enough comedy without making Jason himself comedic, where, God, that movie just hits on every level. Part four, from a terror standpoint, I thought Jason was his most aggressive and threatening in part four. From a pure Jason standpoint, part four... And then three, I love the surrounding characters of the campers. So I would go six, four, three, and then it's kind of a hodgepodge after that. I actually like part seven a lot.
Yeah.
They're really good films. This one, you know, everything in the kitchen sink, and they went too far. I do think it was the right place for us to start.
I think we had a really good podcast, and I think it's going to be very entertaining. If you just look at the initial, it's funny. You look at the initial eight movies. They're now. When you take in Jason Goes to Hell,
if you're going to factor in all,
if you're going
entries,
to factor in the numerical superiority of these movies, we may as well just start channeling Galileo. Anytime you make that many films, continuity is going to get shot to shit. And not continuity. What's the word I'm looking for?
Well, continuity's a big
continuity,
thing.
Yeah.
Because these, much more so than the Halloweens and whatnot, these films really disregard. Each director came in and said, all right, I want Jason to look like this. I don't care what he looked like in the last one. I want to approach him this. They disregard, there's no reverence to what happened beforehand.
Right.
In one.
Possibly you'd a starting point like, all right, four, he five, died this way, we'll bring him back based on that. But then all rules are out the window.
4, 5, and 6 bring you the same character of Tommy Jarvis. So in part four, that's when a young Corey Feldman is playing an adolescent Tommy Jarvis. Then in part five, it's a different actor in a mental institution. And in part six, it's Tom Matthews of Return of the Living Dead fame. They're still playing the same character throughout. Yeah. But then... They try to have the continuity, but I'm with you. And again, it comes to my treatise on the 80s that the doctor will write someday. Part 6 is a quintessential 80s horror movie in that it gives you everything. Does the girl that's from Can't Buy Me Love, Darcy DeMoss, does she show her boobs in that? I don't remember. She's riding some guy in the trailer, but I don't know if we see her tits.
No, you don't.
But otherwise, it's a balance.
Remember, Can't Buy Me Love. There's only one titty quite this pretty.
She's in part six.
But that girl. Again, she doesn't show the titty.
Opening cameo of
Tony. I'll go to my grave not knowing if that other titty is that pretty. I've never seen him.
We're going to find out one of these days. That was menacing.
Or else.
Tony Goldwyn of Metro Goldwyn Mayer fame would be in the movie Ghost. He has a cameo at the beginning.
Arnold Sixth Day?
Right.
You know what? We'll do that one down the road.
Yeah, that's the best one to go to.
That is the best one to go to. But I stand by my call to start at the bottom and work our way up.
I think we had a very entertaining podcast out of this. I think it was worthwhile. I think it'll get people interested in the series. And
it would make more sense to start at the Genesis and move your way up. But we're not going to go through 8 films.
Right. I do want to mention one thing, though. Tut asked earlier what we think of the remake. And when I initially
Seen the remake?
When I initially saw the remake, I certainly was nowhere near as disappointed as I was when I saw the Rob Zombie Halloweens. For Cade and I, that was done.
The Rob Zombie Halloween, the latest Nightmare on Elm Street reboot, it was one of the better.
It was. And I saw it in the theater in 2009, and I've probably seen it twice since, and it's grown on me a little bit.
Yeah.
But what I think I'm getting at here, and I'm not sure what I'm getting at here anymore, but there's something to this particular series that if you get into it, if you're fans of the films, and really, like I said, you're either for it or against it.
Tut is against
it. There was an article, Cade, that you sent me recently. I forget which site it's from. One of the horror sites.
Birth, Movies, Death. It was BC's article, Collins' article.
BC's.
It was a good article in that he's a fanboy like us. He grew up on these films. And it was like, you know what? I'm at that point now where I kind of want them to be retired. I'm just tired of bitching about...
What he said, I could not have agreed more with his sentiment, which is, okay, if they make another Halloween, whoever does it, with Michael Myers, if they make another Friday the 13th with Jason Voorhees, yes, I'm going to buy a ticket and I'm going to go see it at the theater. If they make it, I'm going to go see it. But at the same time, if they never make one ever again,
I'm fine with that.
And I read that article that you sent me and I was like, you know what? I agree wholeheartedly. They can make another one, and I will buy a ticket. If they don't, I don't care.
Watching this made me appreciate stuff like It Follows. I had
different
more,
animal. Totally different animal.
It might be, but in terms of the horror genre, I was just kind of like,
in the last 20 to 25 years has done a dynamic change.
But you know what, guys? To me and Mincy, these movies are like to you and Cody, the comic book movies.
Yeah.
You know, we look at a new Jason or a new Michael Myers movie as a new Spider-Man movie, how you guys see it. I mean, those properties that you hold so true from your childhood, that's how we look at these. So it's like the idea of a new Spider-Man gets you all jazzed up and you're just constantly on edge. Are they going to do it right? Are they going to do this? And what his article was like, basically, as a horror fan, I've been hurt so much, and I've been teased so much that it's going to go this direction, that direction.
It's kind of like a Fantastic Four fan.
It's a great analogy. I've been hurt so many times, and I've been promised things so many times, and it's never happened, especially with the studios involved with Halloween and Friday 13th.
Yeah.
They hold on to these properties, and they suffocate them, and then when they finally do pop out a product, it's going to hurt you because it's never good.
I thought that was
it's like, you know what? You do what you're going to do. Make a Halloween movie. Make a Friday the 13th movie. I'll watch it, but I'm not going to... I'm 40 years old at this point. This is what this guy was saying. He's like, I got a kid. I'm not going to waste this mental energy on it anymore as a fanboy.
It's the best thing Rob Zombie ever said about it. And he took a very defensive stance, and we can go into that until the cows come home. But there's one thing that he said... And it goes back to BC's article, Cade. You know, if they never make another one, I don't care. Rob's, you know, the universe from the earlier films, it's always there. And that's what Rob Zombie said when his defiant stance was, hey, if you don't like my movie, don't watch it. He was like, it's not like by me making this movie, all of the previous Halloween universe has been burned up and you can't see it. Don't watch my movie. And I was like, you know what? Rob, you're right. I'm never gonna watch his Halloweens again. I'm always gonna go back to the well and watch those movies.
Yeah, I just wish we hadn't made the mistake of watching his movies.
But you know what?
I'm still covered in the slime of slimy Jason after watching Rob Zombie's Halloween.
But it's true. But see, BC makes a great point. It's like, you know what? I don't care if they ever make another one again. I can always go back to the original universe that I loved as a kid, as a teenager, as a college student. I can always go back to this. I don't need it anymore.
Pick your passion, pick your poison, and if they give you something, great. But don't stay up awake bitching about it and moaning
about it. At this point, I'd rather see, you know what? There's a term was used in the Doctor's first article about bloody murder movies, derivative. The slasher genre is derivative, meaning it's repetitive, it's been done before. Rather than remake a Halloween, a remake or reboot a Friday, make your own thing. Make a slasher. I don't care if it's at a summer camp or in a small town like Halloween. Make your own thing. Create a new serial killer with his own thing. It doesn't matter if it's derivative, if it's the same sort of vein. Do your own thing. Rather than remake or reboot it, do something else. Go that route. But I thought BC had a good point in that no one watches slasher movies anymore. It's all horror today. It's all Paranormal Activity. It's all Insidious. It's all supernatural stuff. You know, I enjoyed that movie, The Witch, but it's the same thing. It's a supernatural bent. No one's making these movies. No one's watching them anymore. Maybe it is time for them to die on the vine rather than do the same old shit. I don't know. I'll buy a ticket, but at the same time, like BC said, if they never make one again, I'm fine with that too.
At least we're passionate about something.
If you're going to remake a slasher movie, the least you can do is come up with original characters.
I stand behind what we did tonight.
No, yeah. Absolutely.
I think we picked the right one. I hope on Friday 13th you settle in with a nice glass of something. Because
you'll need it.
And a cigar. Several glasses of something. And just listen to us pontificate our brilliance. I don't know if you noticed that when I was talking about Stuart feedback. I was like, fellow podcast legend. I threw myself into it.
Great Scott!
Great Scott!
Great Scott, Kane!
It felt like a good way to get back into the swing of things.
Sure did. And, hey.
I don't care what Tut says.
Come visit the TNCC at Cats Fest.
Yeah, let's end on this. Cats Fest is at the end of May. Come see us. Buy a shirt. Get a cigar.
I'll be there ranting.
And we'll be there drinking.
Maybe the doctor will drink this boot on camera or off.
Who knows? You know what? Go ahead and drink that boot while we're here.
On camera?
Yeah, it's just sitting there. Drink it.
Hang on, let me.
That's full of Prince and China.
The essence.
The essence of Prince and China. Drink its purple goodness.
While Mincy is downing that, hit us up on all the social links. Go to Tuesday Night Cigar Club at Facebook. You can hit us at TNCCcast at Twitter. On the Instagram, TNCC_cast.
Podcast.
And hit us at Tuesday Night Cigar Club on YouTube.
YouTube's a big one. Big announcement. We're going to start releasing all of our episodes, previous 30 episodes, in full length on YouTube. So I got to admit, there is something to it to watch us rather than just listen to us.
Yeah.
Not just because we're so handsome.
Well, that is true.
It helps.
I mean, it definitely helps that we're eye candy.
Check out all our entries on Beyond the Pod while you're waiting for another podcast.
And while you're waiting on us in June to get back up to speed, we're going to be putting reviews, movies, cigars on Beyond the Pod. We got one dropping this week, Children of the Corn 2. The doctor is in the house.
The doctor is going nuts on it.
It's a welcome addition to the website. So keep it up, brother. Chug that boot. Get us drink us out of here.
Drink.
Oh wait, real quick. Fritzbeermusic.com. KeithAHowell.com.
KeithAHowell.com. You hear what they?
We haven't done a show in a while. I'm missing my Keith A. Howe fix.
Exactly.
What the hell am I going to write for him?
The Dutch oven. Bring the Dutch oven in.
What am I going to write for him to say to this?
Oh, I'm sorry, Mincy. Are you still not drinking?
Thoughts.
No, we're good. Drink that so we can...
Purple rain! Purple rain!
This is what it sounds like when Tut cries.
Do it. Yeah! Come on, Cody, give me your best boot. Yes! Yes!
Do it!
Do it!
Do it!
There you go.
Do it! Yes!
Now it's a boot.
Ah!
Fuck yeah.
Let's go crazy!
Thank
Let's
you,
go nuts! I can never take the place of your man. Don't let the elevator bring us down, baby. Thank you,
everyone, for joining us. Tuesday Night Cigar Class, episode 31 in the can.
Yes.
Oh, half that went down the doctor's shirt.
I'll be going down that shirt later.
Well.
Sayonara, motherfuckers. See you next time.
To learn more about the time years ago when I delivered a tangy pizza pie to a horny teenage pajama party, and when the flirtatious babes asked me if there was an Italian sausage in my pants or if I was just happy to see him, I replied with a chipper but menacing, neither. It's a machete. And well, yeah. I don't work at Greasy Tony's anymore, and that's really all you need to know. And in the meantime, to learn more about the cigars and libations enjoyed on tonight's episode, you can visit www.famous-smoke.com, www.cohiba.com, and www.drinkrangercreek.com. For more on O'Brien's Irish Pub, the live music leader in Central Texas, please visit obriensimple.com and download their free smartphone app, where you'll find full beer listings including over 40 on tap, menu information, and a calendar of upcoming live events. To listen and purchase music heard on tonight's program, check out www.fritzbeermusic.com. Thank you for listening to the Tuesday Night Cigar Club podcast. This is Keith A. Howell saying, until next time, friends, unless we see you sooner at the pub. So keep it smoky, and for God's sake, keep it ballsy as well.